How's it going, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to a very, very special episode of the podcast. It is our third annual No Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast Slammy Awards. On No Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast, we're your Canadian-based WWE podcast that reviews and discusses about the WWE and award shows like this, and no holds barred on anything we say, pun intended. You can follow the podcast on Twitter and join in on the conversation, and as you did, join in on the voting by tweeting at NoHoldsBarWP and our Twitter page for these at NHBWP Slammies. As well, you can follow and listen to all previous episodes of the podcast on YouTube, Spreaker, and Podbay. Podbean. Did I say Podbay?
You in the bay, I guess.
It is, I guess. I don't know. It's a good site. I discovered it recently. I think someone mentioned to me a while back, but discovering it recently. Anyways, welcome, guys, to the third annual NHBWP Slammy Awards. And again, as we've said in the past, this has no affiliation with what WWE does. This is strictly our own opinions and yours out there, as I made a Twitter page and asked you guys to give me your nominations.
This is my favorite show of the year. Yep. Like, I look forward to this every year. I start the list of No Holds Barred Slammies.
The list the beginning of corporate Cappy. Yeah,
I start it from the beginning of the year all the way to the end. So,
God, it's gonna be a good show, guys. So,
it's gonna be a long one though.
I got my Steve Weiser right here.
Make sure you got your popcorn and you're sitting down for a couple hours. You might need it for this show.
I got your, you know, whatever you need to do. Just sit there and listen, okay? This is going to be a good show. So, and if you're watching on YouTube, I provide some graphics for you. As you can see, the lovely graphics I provide you right there. And if you're not, you're listening to it on Spreaker or Podbean, just listen in. It's going to be fun. You don't have to see anything. But if you'd like to go to YouTube and check it out, go check it out. You know, give us more views. But
do we want to get like a lowdown, since we're not doing the lowdown show this week, of how this is going to work?
So how is this going to work, guys? We have 30 total awards this year, one including our Twitter Fan of the Year award, which will be our first award of the night. So what's going to happen is we'll start off with an award, and I'll just say a Jobber of the Year award. Corporate Cappy here is going to list off our previous winners, if we have them for that, because we do have new categories this year. If we've had previous winners in that category from 2014, 2015, we'll list them off and we'll tell you who we picked back then. And then we'll get into ours for 2016.
And then
right after,
we will get into your.
And then, yeah, after we say our winners and our nominees, we'll get into your responses on Twitter at the end of each category. So that's basically the lowdown of how this is going to work.
Yep.
So we'll get into it right off the bat. Our Twitter Fan of the Year, and guys, we appreciate the love we've gotten from you guys over Twitter in the last half year. You don't know how much it means to us. We've gone from basically nothing to what we are now, and we're so happy what we're doing right now, and we're happy you guys still love for the you guys still have love for the podcast. We really do appreciate it.
Our moment of the year is really that draft video.
Yeah,
that basically skyrocketed our.
And this was tough, okay? So the Twitter Fan of the Year goes to the Twitter fan who we think, you know, provides us with a good humor and interacts with us a lot and, you know, keeps up with the tweets, I guess. And, you know, it is tough because there's a lot of you out there that do tweet us on a daily basis and like tweets.
We are going to give you the honorable mention participation awards.
Yeah. Y'all, everyone who doesn't win this award, you all get a Ms. Participation Award for this.
Put it in your bios.
Yeah, put in your bio NHBWP a nomination or
participation award winner.
I'd love to see that. You get an up for next year's Twitter Fan of the Year if you do that. So this was really tough. We gone through the whole list, and the winner for Twitter Fan of the Year goes to
you look so good to me.
That's right. It goes to at real Michael Chow. Michael Chow, man, your tweets. Your tweets, they get
the
us.
The mentions are just fantastic.
They're just awesome. And
the weekly responses to Raw and SmackDown with your little puns, they're fantastic.
And
as an award, you get your music back for the rest of the year.
You get it for the rest of the year, and that is Rico's theme, the theme we picked out for you. Yeah. And you'll get it every time we read a Twitter response from you on our Lowdown
show.
That's
what you get when you win our Twitter Fan of the Year award for next year, guys. You get your own music for the whole year.
Yeah, for the whole year.
So you're going to want to get that next year so you can beat out. You don't have to listen to Michael Chow's for the rest of the year.
Yeah, you get your own. You know what? Next year, you'll get to pick your own theme song. How about that? We'll even give you that.
If you win the award.
Yeah. But so we'll get into the honorable mentions and the NHBWP Participation Award winners. We have Glorious Greg on Twitter. Thank you,
always,
Glorious Greg.
Always liking every tweet that I do.
Yeah,
so
we
appreciate
it. Yeah, with the podcast and at Real Kyle Masters. Thank you very much. Colin at GamaNU1. We appreciate the love from you too. Love your interactions every single week on the Lowdown Show. Give our YouTube shout-out to our boy King Scampoli.
Always comments on our YouTube videos. He's not active on Twitter, but on YouTube all the time.
Love an honorable mention to you. Yep, participation award for you. Our boy Chuck Wilson.
Who has been like Big Show the last like 3 months. Like,
yeah, in and out.
On. I don't know where he's been. But shout-outs to Chuck Wilson, too. Yep.
One of our newest fans, Casey Salvis.
One of our goons from here.
Yep. Thank you, Casey Sells, for the love of the podcast. And our other goon, Tyler Jones. Thank you, Tyler Jones.
We've turned him into he's a new wrestling fan this year, so he's learning. Yeah. He's learning the ropes.
Yeah, he's a casual. Give him a break, guys.
He's learning, though.
Yeah, he's learning.
He's actually going to his first event at the end of the month.
I'm proud of that. I can appreciate that.
Show love to him for that.
Yeah. Next, we can't forget about this guy. Irrelevance, or now being referred to as Tired Irrelevance, with a Bugs Bunny King picture.
With his every weekly different profile picture.
Yeah. Love it, Irrelevance.
You made us put the cap on the responses because you were so into our Twitter response.
You were the comedic relief for us, definitely for sure.
But we appreciate you wanting to post 12 tweets to us.
Craig Messi. Definitely. I like your interactions with multiple podcasts. The multitasking you have for showing appreciation to each podcast is awesome. I see what you do, and you got a lot going on in your life right now. So, you know what, Craig Messi, got to give a big shout out to you. Next, Tony Mercer. You know, you're in and out just like Big Show, but you know what? I love that you're interacting with the podcast, and I love your responses, man. Keep it up.
And my favorite, probably best, what is it?
Twitter
handle.
Hootran Superman.
Or my man, Hootran Superman. But he was upset that we took it off of SoundCloud or something like that.
You know what? Hootran, if you want to pay for my SoundCloud account, you want to go ahead.
We'll
I gotta pay for
it.
A lot of shit here in this podcast, and you know we don't until we start generating revenue. We can't have
a GoFundMe account.
Yeah, GoFundMe, get our SoundCloud. Yeah, there you go, Hootran. If you start up a GoFundMe account, you know maybe we'll get it back up on there. But
so congrats to all the winners.
Congrats to all the
all
participation
awesome.
Award and congrats to our Twitter fan of the year in Real Michael Chow. So Twitter fan. Is out and put aside.
So next, we'll get into our first WWE award, and that is Jobber of the Year.
Oh, God. There's been some jobbers this year, ladies and gentlemen.
And we are not including all those random jobbers that were on Raw to start the brand split.
For some reason, had mic time. Don't know why they were ever given the mic. Some of the shit that they said didn't make zero sense.
Like our boy Americo with the mask.
I don't even know what the hell that was.
So our...
Including, though, in one of the nominees is one of those guys who actually turned out to be a, for some reason, a favorite independent
guy. He's got a lot of love for some reason. Our first nomination, James Ellsworth.
Yep.
Guy got himself on the roster, so good for him. Vaudevillains. Dominant NXT tag team.
Yep. Man, job to nothing. Like, literally, they appear once in a blue moon now. It's gone to that point.
Titus O'Neil.
Yeah, nothing really to say about there. A pointless feud with Darren Young where there has so much potential. And after that, you know, he's trying to do this whole Titus brand thing that's really not working out and no one gives a flying shit about.
Yeah, no, like, he had so much potential and they just ruined him.
Yeah.
Jack Swagger, former world champion.
God, he gets traded to get better and then he just jobs coming over the smack. He jobs in the land
Baron
of
opportunity.
He jobs in the land of opportunity. That makes sense. So he's a nominee for
and
jobs.
And lastly, Alicia Fox. Yeah, Shoutouts to Foxy.
Yeah, you know what? Shoutouts. Give props to her, man. She died a couple of times in the last couple of months.
Nia Jax.
Just demolished her. So, yeah, she got jobbed by her, too. I don't remember an Alicia Fox win ever this year or last year.
She's been getting squashed by Bayley now the last 2 weeks.
Yeah.
and our winner is... The Titus brand.
The Titus brand. Titus O'Neil is your jobber of the year.
You could say Ellsworth, but technically he hasn't lost a match yet. He hasn't even wrestled an actual really, besides the AJ Styles joke matches, he hasn't really had a match.
So we have to give it to Titus O'Neil.
Titus O'Neil has probably lost the most matches this year out of any.
Honorable mention to James Ellsworth. You should have deserved Jobber of the Year, but for some reason, WWE felt like you should have been beating AJ Styles. And, you know, that's not really my thing, but whatever.
I don't think Titus won a match on Raw this year. Or SmackDown.
That sucks.
So, I guess you can call him a winner, but congrats to Titus O'Neil, man.
Yep.
Keep handing out those flyers.
Did we have any previous Jobber of the Year? No, we never did. This is a new award, Jobber of the Year. Okay, okay. So, we'll get into your nominees out there and who you voted for on Twitter, and I put out WWE Jobber of the Year. Colin, at GammaNU1, puts James Ellsworth. So, he thinks Ellsworth. Casey Salvas puts Jinder Mahal.
God. I guess since he's been signed the last couple months, he's been jobbing.
Yeah, and he's been jobbing. So, yeah, I can see that. At Tyler Jones puts those Hot Topic fuckboys, and I definitely agree. Fuck those guys, but you know what? I can't even consider them jobber because they were, appeared twice? Three times? I know they lost all three times, but I don't even know. I don't even want. They're not even worthy enough for me to consider them a nominee.
I don't even
want
to talk about them in this.
They win the award for Get the Fuck Off My TV as Fast as Possible award. That's what they get. Tired Irrelevance puts James Ellsworth. Michael Chow puts Jack Swagger, the only superstar to do bad on one brand and be traded to the other brand and still do bad. Hashtag no swag, no wins. And this is why you are Twitter fan of the year. Oh, God.
Yeah, Jack Swagger deserves to be in the conversation as well.
And Phil on Wrestling at Van Dang Goldust, our former co-host, puts James Ellsworth. So he's saying a lot of people picking James Ellsworth.
With good reason.
Yeah. You know, we agree with those. But our own opinion, we're going with Titus O'Neil. Just deserves Jobber of the Year, 100%.
Titus Brand. So, now we'll get on to the next award, which is another new award, the Squasher of the year.
So, this goes out to the person who's the best squasher in this case.
Getting fed
jobber. Fed jobber after jobber. And I guess, you know, you're considered the best squasher, whatever.
So, we've got Nia Jax. Ooh. Obviously.
Yeah.
Bo Dallas, for whatever reason.
For that short period of time, he was squashing random people because that was needed.
Bayley, who was.
Yep. That was even random, too.
They had her squashing random people because they had no feuds for her.
And they didn't know what to do with her because, again, Raw's women's division sucks balls.
Funny nomination here. Goldberg,
because that one squash. And it's Brock Lesnar. Out of all people, you squashed Brock Lesnar. So, you know, we got to consider him.
Yep. And our winner.
And last nominee.
Braun Strowman.
Of course.
Tyler Jones will love this.
That's got to be unanimous, man. Fuck.
He squashed left and right, man.
He did.
Hopefully he gets a better feud going into 2017.
I hope so, too. I need to see this hidden...
Yeah, the savior of
wrestling.
Savior
of wrestling that we've yet to see yet. No, he's savior wrestling. He's been squashing Sami Zayn. That makes sense. Uh-huh. Oh, I see it, Vince. Yep.
And what did the Twitter fans say?
Twitter fans. We got Colin saying Goldberg. Mm-hmm. Casey Salvas puts Braun Strowman. Tyler Jones. Braun.
So I wonder who
Braun
that
Strowman.
Is.
Tired Irrelevance puts Braun.
And then he put a picture of
Braun Strowman's goofy face. Michael Chow puts Goldberg over Lesnar. Lesnar has beat the streak. Cena, Orton, WWE drug policy, and falls victim in 90 seconds to Billy Goldberg. Hashtag what? So he puts Goldberg. Oh, interesting. Okay. Yep. And Phil on Wrestling puts Braun Strowman.
So
unanimously, Braun Strowman wins this award. 100%. Even now, he's not being fed jobbers. He's being fed superstars who obviously are not in the same,
golden truth.
Like, you get fed golden truth. Get fed
Sami Zayn.
They're not the same caliber type superstars, so they're obviously going to get crushed and squashed. This doesn't make any sense.
So, like we said, Braun Strowman, I want to see more of him next year instead of these squash matches. I assume they're going to lead to a match with Big Show.
I know. But, well,
or
whatever.
I've heard there's big plans with him and Roman Reigns.
Ooh.
I'd like to see him squash Roman Reigns. I'd love that.
Yeah. So, congratulations,
Braun. Congratulations, Braun Strowman. Next, we'll get into another new award, Upset of the Year.
Upset of the Year. Okay.
And our nominations are Baron Corbin winning the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal at WrestleMania. Just, it was an upset because he was a new NXT guy coming up.
Yep.
No one saw that coming. James Ellsworth defeating AJ Styles on SmackDown, even though it was tainted because Dean Ambrose.
Yeah, and a lot of people are like, oh, I could see Ellsworth winning because Ambrose is going to help him. Yeah, I mean, but it was still an upset because then you have the people who are realistic, like us, who are like, nah, there's no way they're going to make Styles lose to this fuck. And what do you know? Chins McMahon beat Styles not once, but three fucking times.
Great. Goldberg squashing Lesnar at Survivor Series.
Yep, that's an upset. That's a huge upset. It was worse when if you were actually there like us. Like, we did not see that coming. No, like, that was nuts. I don't think anyone saw that coming.
Not like that.
No.
Heath Slater and Rhino winning the tag team titles at No Mercy.
It sucked because the title tournament had potential, but they ruined it. It was like, I think it was like somewhere in the semifinals where we're like, okay, now it's just obvious that they're going to win the titles. So, but it's still an upset because no one would have thought that Slater would actually get a contract. And out of all people, Rhino would win the title.
House
people.
Of Hardcore earlier in the summer.
As I'm a small indie scene, so who knows? Who would have thought that? So
that's an honorable mention to them.
And our winner
is, I couldn't believe, you were the only one that picked this for our picks at WrestleMania, and I can't believe you won it. Zack Ryder winning the IC title ladder match.
Yeah, by pick of the year for sure, man. No one else picked this. I picked Zack Ryder. I went with my gut feeling, and look at that.
I can't believe that. That was like the upset of the century.
And it's one Noel's Bard Wrestling Podcast upset of the year. Congratulations, Zack Ryder. I don't know if we had any. Did we ever do upset of the year?
No.
No, we didn't do that either? Jesus.
Nope. Our first year, we had like 8 awards.
Yeah, I know. Well, we were new. You know, we were testing things out. So, we'll get into your responses out there. Upset of the year. Colin puts Ellsworth. Okay. Casey Salvas puts Goldberg. God. Tyler Jones puts Ellsworth. Tired Irrelevance puts Ellsworth. Michael Chow puts James Ellis beating AJ Styles not once, not twice, but three times. Hashtag phenomenal dumpster fire. I love that hashtag. And Phil on Wrestling actually puts Goldberg versus Brock Lesnar as the upset of the year.
It was one of the nominations.
It's tough. I'm giving that an honorable mention because literally everyone thought, like, no one knew what the hell this was going to come of this match. Like, everyone's like, oh my god, are they going to copy WrestleMania 20 again? Or is it just going to be Brock suplexing Goldberg a million times? Like, no one. There's not one person in this entire fucking world that was like, you know what? I'm going to predict Goldberg winning in less than 2 minutes.
I thought if it was going to be the opposite, Lesnar would win in like 2 minutes.
But no one saw that coming. That was definitely a good honorable mention. But yeah, we picked Zack Ryder. That's definitely one. Anyone in that match, no one could have picked Zack Ryder, man. There's obviously the people in Vegas voting the underdog, and fucking
won huge
off that.
The way he won it, where
that.
Miz was like gloating about how he's about to win, then Ryder comes out of nowhere, pushes him off, and wins it. It was just
and then they did nothing from there.
Yeah, then he got jobbed. And
If it would have been different if there was already a brand split at that point.
Yeah, maybe he would have been carried a little bit more on SmackDown.
Yeah.
And then now he's
probably
injured.
Not. He probably would have buried again. So, he would have been buried Superstar of the Year.
They just won the tag team title.
And he gets injured.
To become number one contenders for the tag titles, and he gets injured. So hopefully Zack Ryder is not too long because he had
a
pretty good comeback year, I would say. Yeah. Next, going into comeback, we'll do comeback Superstar of the Year. And our nominations are The Miz.
The Miz. Yeah.
Fantastic comeback for him.
Huge.
Turned
huge
himself
man.
Into a great mid-card champion
he
again.
He came from before the brand split being a guy in the mid-card and just gave a shit about him and no one knew what to do with him.
Our next nomination, Brian Kendrick. The guy didn't even have a job last year.
Nope. And he goes in Cruiserweight Classic, gets extremely over with the crowd and Daniel Bryan. And it goes to winning the Cruiserweight champion.
Becomes the top heel in the Cruiserweight division. Yep. Heath Slater and Rhino, obviously. No one predicted that.
No, not at all. Like, huge props to them, especially Rhino going from where we saw him at House of Hardcore in the summer to what he is now in a full-time WWE contract.
And
like, good for him.
Got the WWE Championship once again, Tag Team Championship. Zack Ryder, obviously, for what we just talked about for Upset of the Year. And our winner, I figure that it was 110% Chris Jericho.
100%. This has to be unanimous. Look what the Chris Jericho's done in the last year. I mean, you look back at even at him at WrestleMania, where he was just that boring heel we all knew Jericho to be. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like he's still kind of over, but now he's not over to like what he's done in the last couple months. Is the best work of his career, and he's the most over he's ever been in his entire career. Like right now,
with fucking things like The List and Stupid yeah. Idiot and It, like yeah. getting over.
Like how does that get over? It's incredible. So we're giving Comeback Superstar of the Year 100% to Chris Jericho.
One of the GOATs for doing it 100%. In 2016, having a year like he did. And just he's able to repackage himself and like still be able to be relevant.
Yeah, I agree.
So we'll get into the Twitter fans.
Twitter fans. What are you guys saying for Comeback Superstar of the Year? Gamma NU1 Colin puts, if you don't say a certain someone, then you just made the list.
You're going to get it.
You're going to get it. Casey Salvis, Jericho, sink it in, man. Okay. Oh, I'm getting a phone call from Turkey. I'm not answering you. Tyler Jones puts Jericho. Michael Chow, Chris Jericho, he's been in the WWE for 17 and a half years to change up his gimmick and still get cheered as a heel. Slammy it up, man. I love it.
And the drink it in, man.
Tired of relevance puts The Miz.
Ooh. I'm going to give honorable mention of The Miz, too, man, because that's why he was one of the nominations.
And we are not disagreeing with you either, irrelevance. Definitely.
But it's got to be Jericho.
Yeah, 100%.
Miz is in second place, but I got to go with Jericho.
Interesting pick here by Phil on Wrestling, our former co-host. He puts Comeback Superstar of the Year, Randy Orton.
Hmm.
He wasn't even in our nominee list.
Yeah. That's an interesting pick because, yes, Orton was injured, came back. And then he had that kind of hype feud with Brock Lesnar.
Yep.
And then got into the Wyatt family thing.
And now he's tag team champ. He's really over. I remember Phil saying this before. He still can't believe how over Randy Orton gets now, and it's incredible.
I agree with that. Mm-hmm. And we'll get into Orton later as well. Mm-hmm. Now we'll get into Entrance of the Year.
Ooh, Entrance of the Year.
I do not think we had one of these either.
Did we have one last year? No.
Nope.
Wow.
Did not have an entrance.
Another new award. A lot of new awards this year for the Slammies. So that's why we said it's going to be a good show, guys, ladies and gentlemen. Yep.
So our nominees for Entrance of the Year was Triple H at WrestleMania with Stephanie McMahon and that whole chair thing, and then Triple H.
And then all the people holding the titles, all his championships. We did critique his entrance a little bit. All the people, the skullheads that are holding the championships, they're all holding the same title, the newer belt. They should have been holding the belts he was holding at the time, like the Winged Eagle Championship and
the
world title. That's what they should have been holding, but you know what? Whatever. It was still a sick entrance. You with Stephanie McMahon on that top thing. It was really, really cool. So that's one of the nominees for sure.
And I wonder if any future superstars are going to be... No, because Alexa
Bliss,
Sasha Alexa Banks, and Charlotte were all in his entrance a couple years ago.
So I wonder if any of those people were, could have been like Shinsuke or Ty Dillinger, Bobby Roode.
Maybe, we'll see. Finn Balor at SummerSlam.
Yep.
We had the debut of the Demon on the main roster.
Yeah, the Demon King. Or the Demon. Demon. What was it?
Demon, I hate King? When they fucking say Demon King, because every time I just think of Demon Kane.
Demon Kane. What a tag team, the Demon King and Demon Kane.
Oh my lord, I never want to think
the
of that.
The Demons of Hell.
Next, we got New Day at WrestleMania with the big box of Bootios tipping over.
Yeah, and then dressed like Dragon Ball Z. Fucking epic entrance. I loved it because I'm a super nerd about Dragon Ball Z, and so I love that.
They had the O's that they were just throwing out, the life-size O's.
And then Kofi came out the next night on Raw on his unicorn horn.
Next. Honorable mention to Sasha Banks at WrestleMania.
Entrance, man. With her cousin Snoop Dogg coming out and giving that whole lyric to the song, which I don't know why they never kept and then like actually recorded it. And then
The confetti
and her dress as Eddie Guerrero. Yeah.
She lost the fucking match.
I don't know how you lose the match with an entrance like that.
That was probably the best women's entrance I've ever seen.
Literally. So honorable mention to her, but
our winner.
We got to give it to him.
It's the same guy at two different events. We couldn't pick one. So it's Bobby Roode, the glorious Bobby Roode at NXT Brooklyn / NXT
and Toronto. Oh, were they hashtag glorious. And we got to be in one of them. We can say that we were in one of those entrances, and that was at TakeOver Toronto. With the crowd singing his entire theme. I know NXT Brooklyn started it, But I think ours, I'm biased Canadian. I think Takeover Toronto was better with the whole kids choir at the beginning and then singing the song after you. I thought that was pretty
all
neat.
All the people in the ring.
And then there's also the Brooklyn 2 one.
Where he comes off the big pedestal thing.
Like, that was pretty cool. Like, he's coming from the heavens. Like, Bobby Roode, like, can you imagine, guys? Like, I cannot wait. I hope he debuts before WrestleMania, because I want to hear this at WrestleMania, a WrestleMania crowd, 60,000 plus, or even maybe the Royal Rumble this year, singing his song. Holy crap. He's going to be, like, the most over-fucking person in the world.
I don't think I've ever seen a superstar get this over from an entrance theme.
No, none. I mean, there's two people down there right now, and they're both Canadian, that are getting over for something they're not producing in the ring. I mean, you know, you got Bobby Roode and what he's done in his career, and he should be over right now for what he's done, and he's that popular. But you look at Ty Dillinger, who went from nothing, changing his gimmick to the perfect 10, and now the 10 chance become the most over thing ever.
Because of us
Canadians, our goons started it that weekend in Survivor Series.
Every time the ref has to count outside the ring, it's always 10.
And now apparently they're fucking pissed off about that. Like, come on, get over it, WWE, man. What, you're afraid that the what chance going to be taken over? So what?
New chance.
Stop hanging on to the fucking past. God,
new chance, man. Who cares?
Anyways, so, yeah, our winner is Bobby Roode. Unanimously, it's got to be Bobby Roode. So, in saying that, let's go to your Twitter responses. Let's see what you guys say out there. Colin, GameUNU1, puts any Shinsuke Nakamura, but I agree with Michael Chow, Shinsuke Nakamura Toronto. And that's what Michael Chow said. He loved the violin stampede as he hashtagged it. That was pretty sick entrance, man. Yeah. With all the violins, like, it wasn't just the one, like, Brooklyn. They included the ones all around the ring, and they interacted with him during his certain entrance points in the ring. So Nakamura's entrance is definitely one of those up there with Bobby Roode, the crowd's singing it, and even when the song's done, the crowd is still singing it. We were part of that, too, which was epic. Yep. So, yeah, I'll give honorable mentions to Shinsuke Nakamura. Casey Salvis was Bobby Roode at NXT Toronto.
He was there for that.
He was there. Tyler Jones has got an interesting one. He puts Wyatt's. Now, I don't know. I know he's new here, and I don't know which one, if there's a certain one where they had a sick entrance, or he just loves. I mean, the Wyatt entrance is unique in that sense. You look at what it's like an Undertaker entrance. It's something that's not done by a regular superstar. You can't compare it to anything. Yeah, like, the lights all go well. Everyone has their phone flashlights on. I mean, you couldn't do that back in the day. Yeah, but
if we're talking about a repeat entrance that happens all year long, the Wyatt's probably winning.
And that everyone loves. Like, it's an entrance you can't get bored of, because when you're watching on TV, it's something. But when you're there, it's like, oh, you're like, oh, fuck, I have my phone out. I got to get you. Like, you're excited. Every time I'm at a live event or like a televised event, I'm like, when I hear the why, it's like, that, I'm like, oh, yeah, fuck. I pull my phone out right away, like, quick. Turn flashlight on, and I'm already up.
They call those fireflies, JBL.
I love Michael. Tyler Ellens also puts Wyatt family. That old Randy intro turning into the Wyatt intro is beautiful.
That is cool.
So he's talking about the new one. Yeah, I love that. It's like his Randy Orton's old theme that goes into his current theme, and then it goes into the Wyatt thing. That is really, really well done. Props to CFO Dollar Sign for putting that together, man. Like, they're just unreal over there. And lastly, Phil in Wrestling puts entrance of the year. Naomi's entrance. I mean, okay, I know where he's coming from, and it's definitely helped her, but I know she's injured now, so it sucks, but her new entrance, okay, I'll give it props. It's good. It's awesome.
Hey, yeah, you hated Naomi.
I can feel the glow.
It is unique for the women's division, and I wish they would give her a little bit more to run with, but they're not.
But okay, I can see where you're coming from.
We're going to obviously go with the biased Canadian pick and say Bobby Roode,
100%.
With a glorious award.
Glorious.
Next, we'll get into Cruiserweight of the
Year. Ooh. Cruiserweight. My boy's in the 205 live division.
Mm-hmm. And our nominations are TJ Perkins, the first Cruiserweight champion, won the Cruiserweight Classic.
If you guys don't know, he used to be in TNA as Suicide.
With that awful mask gimmick.
Yeah.
Rich Swann, can you handle this? He's become our favorite Cruiserweight.
Literally, he's become... I only tune into 205 Live to wait for Rich Swann and Cedric Alexander, but...
Rich Swann is going to be a really good Cruiserweight champion. Yeah. Cedric Alexander, the guy is
so good
talent. He's but he hasn't, so they good. Haven't really given him anything yet.
He's getting the Apollo Crews treatment right now in 205.
He's got Alicia Fox's girlfriend.
Ooh, look at that. I mean, okay, at least he's in a feud. I can't complain. And he's not.
They're
in
starting
feud.
This new feud with Noam Dar. So hopefully we'll see where it goes from there. And our winner that we discussed a little bit, and I kind of changed your mind on it, was the Brian Kendrick.
And 100%, I agree now, man. You see where he's come from. He went to the Cruiserweight Classic as like his last chance to get back into wrestling. He lost, but got a huge standing ovation from the crowd. He got so much props from Daniel Bryan. Everybody saw that and like, you know what, we got to sign this guy. They signed him. He became the Cruiserweight champion.
Yeah, the way he won the title was he was like, this is my last chance. This is all I have. I need to beat you, Perkins. And then he played that whole injury angle and then played TJ Perkins. And now
he solidifies himself as the top heel in the 205 division.
And now look what he's doing with Perkins and Swan. He's basically trying to turn them against each other.
Yeah, he's so good. I agree. Now he is Cruiserweight of the Year. And that's why we pick him.
He's basically the anchor of the Cruiserweights right now. Like,
and a lot of people don't see it. You guys got to look at it from the outside here.
Like, yeah, Perkins and Swan are good nominations too, but
they don't hold the division together. Yeah. I think Kendrick plays a huge factor into that.
Yeah, so that's why we are picking Brian Kendrick for Cruiserweight of the Year.
And we never had that before because the Cruiser division is so new. So, let's get into your Cruiserweight of the Year nominations out there. Colin Gamey 1 puts TJP. Interesting, yeah, we all know why. Tyler Jones puts Rich Swann. He can handle this. Tyler Jones can definitely handle this.
I love Rich Swann.
Michael Chow puts TJ Perkins, Cruiserweight Tournament winner, first ever new Cruiserweight champion, and he put a gif of Betty White dabbing.
I never want to see that again.
Tyra Relevance puts Jack Gallagher.
I think it's a little too early to say Jack
Gallagher. I do see where you're coming from, though, Relevance. The guy brings such a unique style to the division. I wouldn't consider him Cruiserweight of the Year, but I do...
He may be a nomination next year.
He might be a nomination next year because he's new to the division right now, and people will start to like him, guaranteed. If they don't, people don't know what the fuck they're watching right now. They need to stop watching 205 Live if they can't get behind him. And lastly, Phil on Wrestling puts Brian Kendrick. He agrees with us, so thank you, Phil, for that response and agreeing with us.
Yep, so shout-outs to Brian Kendrick. It might be his last year in WWE, who knows, but he's making the most of it.
Yeah.
So now we're going to get into our NXT awards.
NXT!
And we actually do have some previous winners for these awards.
The roar of the crowd.
So we're going to start with NXT Tag Team of the Year.
Woo!
And our nominations include American Alpha before they got called up.
Yep.
They were tag team champions down there. Team DIY, Gargano and Ciampa.
Yep. Do it yourself.
Yep. The Authors of Pain.
Authors of Boring.
They won the, what do you call it, the Dusty Rhodes Classic.
Yeah, good for them, sure.
They
that was
bad.
A shitty match.
They're bad. And TM61, they're a pretty good tag team.
Yeah. They're all right. We like them. Like I said in the reaction, we like those guys. They're all right.
And our winners, like...
This has to be unanimous, guys. I don't know. You can't question this. The Revival. They got to be the winners. You look at what they've done. Since the beginning of 2016 till now, they've been the most dominant tag team I've ever seen.
In NXT.
Even
they're
more.
Two-time champions.
I know. I can even go as far as WWE because, like, look what they've done. They solidified themselves as, like, a dominant brand. They're their own thing.
And they're such a good team together. Like, they're very cohesive.
Yeah. And, like, I do not think they're going to be Ascension 2.0 when they get called up.
They better not
I
be.
Think they're going to be there. I think Vince should get behind these guys.
They're bringing
and
back
them.
The old school type wrestling.
Yeah. And they're so good.
The
they're
matches
so
they've
good.
Had with DIY and American Alpha, they've just been such good matches. Like, the amounts of times that they no-sell finishers.
Yeah, oh my god.
They kick out with more finishers than John Cena.
Literally, the Revival have literally kicked out, I think, of more finishers this year than John Cena has in his entire career.
100%.
That's a lot. If you don't know, guys, that's a lot.
So I think the Revival has had the most dominant tag team run.
Oh, for sure. 100%.
I've ever seen.
And I'm going to have to say...
Even more than New Day, I think. Like, even though New Day's held the title,
yeah.
I think... The Revival's looked more dominant than
I think
New
so.
Day.
That'd be a sick feud, then. The Revival versus the New Day would be an unreal
if
feud.
If only, like, the Revival still had the titles when they got called up, and they could have been like, well, we're the longest-reigning NXT champions against the longest-reigning WWE champions.
Oh, man, that'd be sick. Maybe they'll win it back. Who knows? Because maybe they're not going to get called up soon. Maybe they'll win it back at TakeOver San Antonio.
So Gargano and Ciampa, like, they've had the good matches with Revival, but they just won their first match against them. So
yeah,
we'll see what happens with them. But shout outs to the Revival, the winners for this year by far. Last year's Tag Team of the Year. Our nominees were American Alpha.
Wow, two-time nominees.
Blake and Murphy.
Oh,
with
yeah.
My girl Alexa.
Wow.
And Dash and Doss in the Revival. And last year, our winners were Blake and Murphy with
Blake
my girl Alexa.
Blake and Murphy won last year. We picked Blake and Murphy? Why? I don't remember.
They were tag team champions.
Oh, I guess.
And
so.
It was all due to my girl Alexa Bliss.
Yeah,
like,
I guess.
Be real
sure.
Look at them now. They're not even a tag team.
I know. They're terrible.
See? So I should have just put Alexa Bliss for NXT Tag Team of the Year last year.
Yeah, oh yeah.
But, sure. But so yeah.
And we weren't big NXT the year before, but yeah.
Yeah, we didn't really have the network, really, before NXT took off.
Yeah. So yeah.
The Twitter fans.
Twitter fans.
They vote for that.
What are you saying out there for NXT Tag Team of the Year? Colin saying, Tag Team of the Year, Revival. Who Trans Superman saying, The Revival. Casey Salvis says, The Revival. Tired Irrelevant says, The Revival. And Phil on Wrestling says, The Revival.
So we don't even have to say
unanimous
anything more about that. Lee, you guys have spoken. We've spoken.
Revival
are the
GOATs
the
for
best.
This year. 100%.
Next, we'll move into NXT Rookie of the Year.
Ooh.
And we've got some interesting nominees for this
one. We have
one.
Definitely interesting nominees here.
We've got Austin Aries. Fantastic.
Yeah, great. And
great
performer. Has shown that he's an unreal commentator.
And he's going to be going up to the cruiserweight division when he gets healthy from his eye injury, that gruesome eye injury he got from Shinsuke.
Ugh, the pictures of that.
Next, we've got Eric Young, our boy EY.
Yeah. Very young in the NXT division
with
right
Sanity.
Now.
Sanity. It looks like it's going to get over as a top faction.
Yeah.
No Way Jose.
Yeah! No Way Jose.
Oh, my God.
I love this guy. Just because of his interest and his whole gimmick. He's sick.
She's probably going to be NXT Woman of the Year next year, Ember Moon.
Yeah, she's so good. And her finisher is just the best finisher I've ever seen. Like, a off-the-top turnbuckle stunner. Like, come on. You can't get any better than that.
Nope. And our winner, obviously, Bobby Roode.
Bobby Roode, Rookie of the Year. Unreal, man. Just look where he's come from, and now he's looking
like
he's
going to be... People want him called up already. They don't even want him on NXT anymore.
Yeah, he looks like he'll be the front runner for the next NXT championship run. So it looks like Joe or Nakamura will get called up.
So over, and he plays that character so well. Yeah. I've read an interview with him that he did, I think, while he was up here for a takeover, and he said, like, I wasn't really into the gimmick at first, but then, like, once I started getting into it and the crowd was getting behind it, now I just love it. Now he loves playing that gimmick.
And look what he's done at just getting over alone is his entrance.
Nope.
And his gimmick.
And he plays the heel very well.
Very, very well. So yeah, let's get into your Twitter responses, your NXT Rookies of the Year. Colin, I Game Anyone puts Bobby Roode. Casey Salvas puts Bobby Roode. Tyra Rollins puts the glorious Bobby Roode. Phil on Wrestling puts Ember Moon.
I think it's a little premature. She hasn't had a title match yet.
Yeah.
She has had a couple good
she's
matches.
She's only a month and a half old. So that's a little jump in the gun there, no self, Phil, but I can appreciate your response. So thank you for your response. And NXT Rookie of the Year.
All right.
Did we have an NXT Rookie last year?
No, we did not.
Oh.
No NXT Rookie. But we did have NXT Female of the Year last year.
Ooh.
And the nominations were Bayley, Charlotte, and Sasha Banks.
Wow.
Think of where they're at now.
Yeah, I know, exactly.
All three of them are on Raw.
Poor Bayley.
And I think I voted for Sasha Banks last year, obviously, and I'm pretty sure you and No Self Phil voted for Bayley.
Yeah, probably. I think we did vote for Bayley.
But I'm saying Sasha Banks. Like, it's not even close. Anyways, this year's nominees for NXT Female Superstar of the Year, Bayley, before she got called up. She held the title for a long time before she lost it to Asuka. Asuka's another nominee.
Man.
Self-explanatory. And Nia Jax was a dominant force before she was called up.
And your obvious winner, if you guys do not pick her, there's something wrong with you, or you just don't watch NXT, period.
This and the Revival might be the slam dunk awards of the year, like the easiest
one. And the winner is Asuka. And I look at Twitter right now. All y'all say Asuka. Colin, Casey, Irrelevance, and Phil all put Asuka. Interesting.
Not even close.
It'll
be funny to see.
And I understand you guys didn't vote on that.
Hopefully.
Either you didn't see it or you saw it and you're like, it's obviously Asuka. You don't need to vote.
Like, look at how dominant she's been all year long.
Yeah.
So hopefully an Asuka Ember Moon feud comes next year.
That'd be sick. That'd be cool.
For 2017. Next, we've got NXT Male Superstar of the Year.
Yes, this is this. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this was very tough. A lot of back and forth responses here. So
last year we voted for Kevin Owens,
yep.
Samoa Joe, and Jeez. Finn Balor. And Finn Balor was our winner last year. He was dominant last year in NXT.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
He carried that brand last year.
And is a nominee for this year. Look at that. Yep.
Male Superstar of the Year. Finn Balor before he was called up.
Yep.
Bobby Roode.
Yeah.
Ty Dillinger.
I'd pick, just a bias as hell pick, I'd pick Ty Dillinger. Look how over he is now to where he was the start of the year. Incredible.
Samoa Joe.
But then you got these two guys.
And Shinsuke Nakamura. And we debated back and forth between Joe and Nakamura who should be Superstar of the Year, but we finally decided to go with Nakamura.
Shinsuke Nakamura. Honorable mention to Samoa Joe. Because if there wouldn't be one without the other. They've had this incredible feud for the last half a year.
And even before Nakamura, Joe had that great feud with Balor as well.
Yeah, and then Nakamura had that basically almost, you know, people still think it's match of the year ever. Like, out of anyone this year.
And he had good matches with Austin Aries as well.
So, you know what? Both had an incredible year, but we went with Shinsuke Nakamura for NXT Male Superstar of the Year. Let's get into your Twitter responses. Colin, give me a new one, puts Shinsuke. Casey puts Nakamura. And Tyler Evans puts Samoa Joe. So he went with the Samoa Joe pick. And we understand where we respect that, Tyler Evans. That's a really, really tough pick. So we understand when you went with Joe there.
Mm-hmm. NXT Feud of the Year.
Ooh, and this guy got some same nominees here.
Yeah, we did not have an award for that last year. Nakamura versus Joe.
Yep.
Asuka versus Bayley.
Yep.
American Alpha versus The Revival, which honorable mention, you could say Revival and DIY now.
Yeah.
Bobby Roode versus Ty Dillinger.
Epic. It's only lasted a month, and it's been unbelievable. Just the way that it took place
in Toronto, which made it more special.
Yeah.
I don't think it would have been as over. Like, it would have been over, but it wouldn't have been as special and meaningful as if it wasn't in Canada.
Yeah.
And the winner, which was very close, was
Balor
and Joe for Feud of the Year.
And we picked Balor and Joe because we gave Nakamura a Male Superstar of the Year. If we gave him Feud of the Year, it just didn't seem fair because Nakamura and Joe were the front runners for Male Superstar of the Year.
We wanted to give Joe some love, too.
You look at the both feuds between Nakamura, Joe, and Joe and Finn Balor. We do definitely agree that Finn Balor feud, it looked like it meant more in a way. And it was just, I don't know what to say. How am I trying to word this? I can't even word this.
The way that it played out, like the way that Joe won the title at a live event, like no one had seen that coming. They did that again, but that
like it was something we've already seen before. So it makes sense that the Balor and Joe would come first, and why we picked them as
and Balor's the unreal year. Entrances that he had, like with his what do you call it? His Jack the Ripper and all those other set. Like, it was just a very physical, personal feud, which Joe is doing with Nakamura now, but we feel that Balor and Joe was a more groundbreaking feud for NXT.
100%. 100%.
So, what did the Twitter fans say?
Twitter fans, Feud of the Year, what are you guys saying out there? Colin and Gamma, NU1 puts Revival and DIY. Definitely respect you for that pick. Casey Salvas puts Joe versus Nakamura. Okay, yep. We respect you again for that. And Tyler Rollins is with us with Samoa Joe and Finn Balor. So we can definitely 100% respect you for that pick, Irrelevance.
I think that's going to go down as one of the best NXT feuds 100%. Of all time.
Even before NXT was not a thing, people would not have thought Prince Devitt and Samoa Joe would ever feud
in WWE,
and then they have, and it's been the most great, one of the greatest feuds we've ever seen.
They were probably the two with AJ Styles, the top talents that were never in WWE before.
100%.
Now they got here, and now look at them.
Yeah,
I expect them to have another unreal feud on the main roster someday. I'd love that.
100%.
And
I can't wait for that.
Our last NXT award is NXT Match of the Year.
And do we have previous winners for that?
No, we did not.
Did we? I think we might have.
Oh, yeah. In 2014, I had to listen to the video again. It was in one of the categories for our regular Match of the Year. So I made So oh, it was okay. NXT match of the year. We had Sami Zayn versus Adrian Neville at NXT TakeOver.
Wow. God, that's, you think about it now, not a lot of people remember that. But yeah, Neville was one of the first NXT champions, and that was a real feud back then. And that was big, too, because when El Generico went over to WWE, he took his mask off, and the character Sami Zayn started, and people were like, wow, like, this is, what is this? And it's taken off since then. So.
For some reason, look at what, I mean, both of them aren't being given the spots that they deserve. We'll get into that later.
Yeah.
We did not have an award for this last year for some reason.
Yeah.
So our nominations were DIY versus The Revival at NXT Brooklyn.
Yep.
You could even go with the one at Toronto as well, the 2 out of 3 falls.
Honorable mentions to that 100% because that was an epic match.
Finn Balor versus Samoa Joe in a steel cage at NXT TakeOver The End. Great match. DIY versus The Revival. Okay, I had DIY The Revival, 2 out of 3 falls. Sami Zayn versus Shinsuke Nakamura at NXT TakeOver Dallas. And Samoa Joe versus Nakamura at NXT TakeOver Brooklyn.
Now, this was very, very tough, ladies and gentlemen. All these were epic matches. You go back and watch every single one of them. It's so tough to say. But we decided to go with Sami Zayn versus Shinsuke Nakamura at TakeOver Dallas. That is still being talked about to this day as even WWE Match of the Year. It was such a good, well-put-together match.
And
the hype behind it was incredible.
And it wasn't even for a main title or anything.
And it was Nakamura's debut. And it was just, oh, it just set the bar for Nakamura. Like, how do you, you can't have a better debut. Nakamura being like the most hottest free agent WWE signed from New Japan Pro Wrestling. And his first match is against Sami Zayn, and it's basically match of the year.
And it was Sami Zayn's last NXT match as well.
Yeah, exactly.
That was his, what a way to go out for him.
Yeah, so
having a match like that.
That's why we picked it to be match of the year. And you guys out there have to agree with us when we say that, because I go back and watch it more often now. Like, it's incredible.
And it makes it even better because it was a match that didn't have a title on the line either.
Exactly.
It was a match that didn't need a title to make it special.
Exactly. And it was so good. The crowd chanting "Fight Forever" and just, it was just great from start to finish. It was so good.
It was a tear-dropping match for the city.
Teardrop. Ooh.
But shout-outs to DIY and The Revival, though.
Yeah, 100%. The one at the NXT TakeOver Toronto, even the one where we watched live, like, that match was epic. Literally, probably one of the greatest tag team matches I've ever seen. The 2 out of 3 falls. It was just, oh, incredible. Oh, God. So we got New Year responses out there. NXT match of the year. Colin, IKMNU1 puts Joe versus Balor TakeOver The End in the cage match. Interesting. Casey Salvis puts Revival and a DIY at NXT Toronto. Yep, he was there for that. So good on you, Casey, for voting for that. Definitely an epic match. Can't not agree with you there. Tired Irrelevance puts every TakeOver match the Revival was involved in. So huge Agreed. Revival fan here from Tired Irrelevance. Phil on Wrestling puts NXT match of the year, Sami Zayn versus Nakamura. So he agrees with us. That definitely was an epic match. I remember Phil telling me that that's going to be match of the year, and it's going to win WWE match of the year 100%. So
that wins our NXT match of the year.
Yep, and it'll probably win WWE match of the year.
Probably.
Not going to lie.
Next, we'll move into manager of the year.
Ooh, manager. And there's this touchy subject here because a lot of you guys didn't really vote properly on this one, but
last year our nominees were Paul Heyman, Lana, and Ric Flair.
Ric Flair.
And last year I voted for Ric Flair.
Mr. Lit himself.
And I'm pretty sure 2014 was Paul Heyman with Brock Lesnar in the streak.
We'll get to our nominees this year.
Yep. So our nominees this year are Paul Heyman.
He's always going to be a nominee. This guy's going to be a nominee every goddamn year.
Lana with Rusev, the comeback with Rusev. Mm. Yeah. Lana. There's not enough time in the day to talk about how much we love Lana.
Yeah.
Bob Backlund, but where has he been lately? Did he really make Darren Young great again? Did that really happen? Paul Ellering with the Authors of Pain.
Yeah, I guess you can see it from a manager standpoint how good he has been, but and fuck Authors of Pain.
They had him up on the cage.
He's even in a cage, guy. He risked his life up there. That definitely deserves a nomination.
And our winner, I don't know how you guys can even question this. It's got to be Maryse.
You see what she's done, guys. This last, since coming back to WWE with Miz and what she's done for Miz since then, she's helped them win matches. She's helped them win that Intercontinental Championship match and keep it. And she just, She's just a great manager character. Great heel, man. She's made perfect for Miz.
She's made such a big impact on his matches.
It's incredible, and she's just so good. Like, it just fits. They can keep her with Miz forever if they had to.
And the thing is that when you go into a Miz match, you always have to think about what is Maryse going to do.
Yeah, what is Maryse doing? Unless she's banned from ringside, you're like, okay, yeah. Maryse is going to have some play into this, and as we saw Survivor Series live, she, you know, rang the bell and confused Sami Zayn. So, look, she had a play into that. So, definitely, I think Maryse is definitely a manager of the year for her, you know, her superstar and, obviously, husband.
Yep.
So, Maryse, and let's get to your responses out there. Calling a game at NU1 puts Paul Heyman. You know what? I can't hate on you for that because you look at Paul Heyman and what he's done for Brock Lesnar. But I mean, I just feel like this year he hasn't done as much as he has with Brock Lesnar in the past.
Yeah.
I don't know. Hasn't been a Paul Heyman kind of year.
It would have been a great year for anyone else, but it'd been an average year for him.
Yeah, 100%. Casey Salvas puts Maryse. He agrees with us. Tyler Jones put Mrs. Bitch. Yes, that's Maryse, everybody. Michael Schau puts Maryse. Mizzy can't seem to win without her. # Maryse Participation Award. And he puts the gift
of closing her hand. Yeah.
Tyler Relevance puts none. Maryse is a wife and Heyman is an advocate.
But okay. I don't agree with that because Maryse, yes, she's a wife, but she's also a manager.
A manager.
Look at all the years Stephanie McMahon or Miss Elizabeth was with
with Macho Man. She was a manager.
It still counts as a manager.
And Heyman is an advocate, but he's also a manager for Brock Lesnar. He's at ringside for every one of his matches. He is a manager
type
person.
That's what a manager is.
And Phil on Wrestling puts Maryse also.
So besides Irrelevance, everyone else was unanimous.
Yeah. So thank you, Irrelevance. We still appreciate your input. So thanks for your input.
Okay. Now we're going to move on to Return of the Year.
Ooh, I got to get to my notes here. I got the Return of the Year right over here.
We've got two past winners of this award for 2014. We said The Rock returning in Brooklyn.
Wow. Awesome. I remember that. That was sick. It's Rusev. Yep. I remember that.
That segment was awesome. Batista returning at the Royal Rumble.
Ugh.
Bautista.
Boo.
The poor guy got ruined Blue by Daniel Tista. Bryan. And Sting's debut/return with WWE was the winner.
Oh, yeah.
That was the winner of 2014. Last year for the return of the year was the Dudley Boys.
Yep. Okay, I remember that.
My boy Alberto Del Rio.
Ooh.
No one saw that coming with John Cena.
Yep, I remember that. Yeah, Zeb Coulter. That was a shocker of the year.
Yeah. And the Brothers of Destruction, Kane and The Undertaker, returning together.
Yep.
And the winner last year was my boy, Alberto Del Rio,
who's no longer 100%. With the company. Yep, sad. Rest in peace.
So now, getting into this year's nominees, we've got Seth Rollins at Payback when he came back to pedigree Roman Reigns and the crowd went ballistic.
Yep.
Triple H returning on Raw to help Kevin Owens win the Universal
freaking
title.
Freaking pedigreeing Roman Reigns on the outside and Rollins in the ring.
Nikki Bella at SummerSlam as the fifth participant.
Which is weird because she came back as the heel and then suddenly became face the next SmackDown.
But it made
sense.
With
the double turn, yeah.
Yep. And then Goldberg on Raw.
Yeah. I mean, we knew it was coming, but again, it was awesome to see him in the ring after like 12 years. So, yeah, incredible.
It was a Marco moment for sure. And then
honorable
the biggest market, what?
Honorable mention to Cesaro on Raw after WrestleMania. I think that was pretty
good. No one saw him coming back that early, so yeah, I can see that. And their winner... it's got to be Shane McMahon.
Shane McMahon. Like, you can't say that anyone predicted that. Like, I mean, I was like, oh, I wonder if Shane McMahon would come out. And then jokingly. And then he actually came out. And I'm like, no fucking way. Are they trolling us? No. There comes Shane
O'Mac
McMahon.
Shane O'Mac comes out
to his dunks. I'm like, Jesus.
To confront Vince and Steph.
That was huge. And that basically was the start towards the brand split. Like, that was just awesome. And it was just an epic return. There hasn't been an epic return other than that this year, I think. So, yeah. Shane McMahon, 100%.
That was like 100% Marco moment. Like, getting out of your chair. Like, holy shit, is this actually happening?
Yeah.
So, Shane McMahon wins it this year. For
did we ever have a return of the year? Oh, no, we already did that. Yeah, we did. So, your Twitter responses. Cullen at GameN1 puts, I would say Goldberg, but that's probably the go-to answer. So, Seth Rollins on Raw. Or at Payback, sorry.
Mm-hmm. As one of our nominees.
Casey Salvas puts Goldberg. Michael Chaup is Goldberg, 12 years is a long time. And what an impact return to shock the world. # your last world tour. Tyler Relevance puts Orton. Interesting. Okay. I forgot about that. And Phil on Wrestling puts Mickie James Return of the Year.
Wow.
Yep, I forgot. I totally forgot about that too. But good, Phil, for pointing it out to us. No, it was supposed to be Trish Stratus. We found out after, but what a shocker. Mickie James to appear on the Videotron to challenge Asuka. It's like, what? Like, we haven't seen Mickie James in who knows how long. We saw her at a House of Hardcore event again. That's the second person in a row we've seen at an independent scene who gets a shot now. And that's going to be three.
And Bobby Roode and Eric Young was the main event.
And we saw Chris Hero in that same one. He just got signed by WWE again. So... God.
Well, if you want to get signed by WWE, go to House of Hardcore.
Yeah, I guess. Make sure we go to it, you know? Yeah. We'll get you over.
So Shane McMahon, Return of the Year.
Yeah, 100%.
We're going to move on to another one of our favorite awards, our Future Endeavor of the Year.
Ooh, we've had that in the past. I remember those awards.
Yes, we have. Future Endeavor of the Year in 2014. This was controversial. Justin Roberts. Yeah. God, he's been gone for that long.
Jeez, and that was such a shitty, because him and Michael Cole had a little dispute at ringside, and he flipped off Michael Cole. Like, come on! Really?
I would flip off Michael Cole.
They too. Really couldn't get over that, and they really fired, like, one of their best announcers of all time. Come on.
The guy who wanted to be an announcer since he was a kid.
Like, how do you do that to a guy like that?
Alberto Del Rio, and then he came back.
Yeah.
And obviously CM Punk won for 2014.
Yeah.
We're not going to get into that.
Oh.
we could talk about that for hours.
Yeah.
And then last year for Future Endeavor of the Year was... The fucking nominees were garbage for this last year. Brad Maddox was a nominee.
Oh my God, I forgot about Brad Maddox. Former GM.
Billy Gunn, after he got fired for
taking steroids or testosterone pills in a weightlifting competition. Nothing WWE related.
But he forgot to tell them about it.
Yeah, oh yeah, I forgot to tell you guys.
And our winner was Hulk Hogan.
Oh yeah. Well, it looks he might be coming back too.
Yep. So, yeah, this year's nominations for Future Endeavor of the Year, Damian Sandow, poor guy.
Yeah, poor guy. Literally poor guy. The guy got so over with the crowd, and they're just like, yeah, you're fired.
Yep. Cody Rhodes.
Yeah, he quit.
Whatever. Wade Barrett. Just left when his contract expired. Just
peace.
Ryback.
He's become a spite WWE guy ever since leaving. He
changed his legal name to Ryback.
How do you change your legal name to Ryback?
Hello, Mr. Ryback.
Yeah, Mr. Ryback.
And he's actually appearing at Niagara Falls Comic Con, which I don't care about seeing him.
Yeah, I don't really want to go to that either.
And our winner is my boy, Alberto Del Rio.
Yeah. Look what he's done since he's leaving. He's opened a restaurant. He started his own MMA company. He's had relations with my girl Paige, so, you know, good for Del Rio.
And he's still wrestling on the side as well. Yeah, he's having a match with Kurt Angle coming up.
So, that'll, you know what, good for Del Rio, and I think he deserves definitely the Future Endeavor of the Year. Honorable mentions to Cody Rhodes, who, look what he's doing. And he went even behind WWE's back and using the Rhodes name, too. And then, I guess, honorable mentions to Damian Sandow. I don't know why you go to fucking TNA. Look how much a dumpster fire that was.
His name's, something Rex or something.
Yeah, I don't even know if he's still there or not. I don't know. Like, that's how irrelevant you become. No pun intended to irrelevance. But that's how irrelevant you become when going to TNA. You just get forgotten about.
Sandow was great.
Unless you're in the Matt Hardy thing, you're getting forgotten about.
Sandow should just go back to the Up, Up, Down, Down channel as Sizzle and do his halftime show.
He should. You know what? Sizzle. Let's go to your Twitter response to Future Endeavor of the Year. Calling again, anyone put Spirit Squad again? Real answer, Cody.
I don't even want to think about
Spirit. Tyler Jones puts Ty Dillinger.
I don't think he understood the question. So
Ty
D. Okay.
Yeah, it's okay. And Michael Chow puts Damian Sandow so over with the fans. Why? Just why? # you're not welcome.
He did have a lot of potential.
Yeah, he did. Got really over. The whole Mizdow thing was like the best work of his career.
Now they're doing that with Cesaro and Sheamus now where one gets cheered, one gets booed.
Yeah, and then didn't he do the...
Then he did the
Macho Man thing with Axelmania, but because of Hulk Hogan, that failed, and that basically was like the, all right, you're out the door now.
Yeah, so ADR wins it, and he did go out on good terms with WWE this time. He says he appreciates what they've done for his career, but he just was not happy with being away from Paige on SmackDown and not being given the title opportunities that apparently he was slated to get when he came back, and he's apparently supposed to have Paul Heyman as a manager, which clearly did not happen.
I mean... I would be upset if I was away from Paige. I'm just saying.
I know you would. You're away from her right now.
Yeah.
So ADR wins Future Endeavor of the Year. Next, we'll go on to Barry of the
Barry Year. Of the Year, guys. So the superstar we think is getting the most buried throughout the entire year of 2016.
We did have this last year. We had Ziggler. Damian Sandow was a nomination.
Oh, yeah.
And our winner was Cesaro last year.
It should have been Damian Sandow because look what happened to him. And yeah, Cesaro, he's technically... I would still say it if this new tag team with Sheamus wasn't working. Because it's semi-working, I can still get behind it a little bit.
Because if we would have had these awards after or during the seven-match series, it's like, what the hell is this leading to?
Literally, yeah.
But now we understand that it might be leading them winning the titles. So Cesaro won it last year for Bear of the Year. He's a nomination again this year.
Yeah.
Brizongo is another nomination. We think this team has a lot of talent that they're not utilizing.
So much fucking talent, and NWE's like, no, we're going to make you dress like
the fashion police.
The fashion police and give out tickets and get buried.
By American
Oh, yeah. What a way to use good potential, Vince.
We thought when they were going to SmackDown, they were going to have a shot. Maybe they will one day. I'm hoping so.
Maybe.
Sami Zayn, the way he's getting treated on Raw right now.
We think that's going to be leading to a trade with SmackDown. That looks like it's going to happen any time now. Can't wait.
Yep. And then honorable mention to the club.
The club who look what they've done in New Japan and now look the fuck they're doing. They just keep getting buried. No tie. I hope they dethrone the New Day. I hope they're the ones to do it. Because literally, they need something. They need fucking something.
Now in WWE. Look what they were in New Japan. Your most dominant.
It's almost like they should have started in NXT or go down to NXT.
Or they should have just kept them with Styles. Why did they have to break up the whole club thing? They got back together and then they
trade the club and Sami Zayn over to SmackDown. Something needs to happen.
Maybe bring Brizongo over. I don't know.
The Usos.
The Usos.
The Usos.
Now that they're healed, they can feud with
the Usos again. They're the Usos again.
And our. Sorry.
Oh, yeah, we won.
And our winner.
We didn't pick the winner
yet. And our winner, and the newest poster child of Where Are You on a Milk Carton?
Neville. Yeah, Neville comes back from being injured, and they just don't even put him back on TV. How? Why don't you just put him in the Cruiserweight division?
He could be the face of the Cruiserweight division.
Why the fuck is he not doing anything?
The guy was a former NXT champion.
Was he posing backstage for these milk cartons? Is that what he's doing?
I don't know, but the guy was a former NXT champ. He won our NXT Match of the Year 2 years ago, and now he's not even on TV.
Yeah, and he's not injured. He's just not being used. At a 3-hour show, he's not being used. That's fucking sad.
We could also put Apollo Crews in this as well.
Yeah, 100%. He's another honorable mention.
But at least he gets a match here and there. We don't see Neville ever.
Dark matches.
Like, where is Neville?
Yeah, where is Neville? Hashtag, where's Neville?
So he wins the award for Barry of the Year. Get him back on fucking TV. Put him in the Cruiserweight division. Do something.
100%. I agree. Free Neville. Hashtag free Neville. Yeah. Let's get to your Twitter responses. Barry of the Year. Colin Gamma NU1 puts all of the Cruiserweights on Raw, I would have to say. I think he probably
205 live now. Give him a chance.
Casey Salvis puts Sami Zayn. Michael Chow puts, I don't know, WWE creative.
Kevin Dunn,
get the Barry. I'm like, yeah. Tyrell Evans puts Rusev. Okay, so he doesn't like the way they're using Rusev. That's interesting. Okay, yeah, I mean, yeah, he's feuding with Enzo Amore. Like, whoa, that's a big up for his career. And before that, I don't know.
He had a U.S. title for a bit.
And then Phil on Wrestling for Barry of the Year is an off-the-page pick here. Britt Baker. Wow. Barry of the Year. That girl who has so much potential with her name and the puns that could have been used after that gets buried. And we never see her again. Hey, not even in NXT.
Hey, she's a local competitor in Pittsburgh. Maybe she'll come out at Forget
it. You just been baked.
She got baked by Nia Jax.
Oh, man. That's just so good. Her name is priceless. Britt Baker.
But we're going to stick with Neville for this one.
100%. Neville, congratulations for being Barry Superstar of the Year. You
can call it congratulations.
Yeah.
Hang on. Let me just cross these ones out here. All right. Next, we're going to go to Turn of the Year.
Ooh, the Turn of the Year.
Now, do we have this?
I don't think we had that last year.
We didn't have it 2 years ago. I know that. Last year, Turn of the Year. Yes, we did.
Oh, we had Turn of the Year last year. Oh, we did.
Kane face turn on the Authority. Yeah, these were pretty bad. Sheamus heel turn on Daniel Bryan and Dolph Ziggler after WrestleMania.
Oh, yes.
And Samoa Joe heel turn on Finn Balor.
Oh.
And our winner was Sheamus' heel turn, because it was, people were just expecting him to come back and finally be heel.
Oh, yeah, I remember that now. And he's the stupid mohawk. Yeah.
So Sheamus won last
year. Debut of the mohawk.
And now look at him now. No one gives a shit about him now.
Yeah. Wow. And a good turn, though, to be.
And turns of the year for this year, we've got Seth Rollins' face turn on Raw with the whole breaking down of the authority thing.
Yep.
Carmella and Nikki Bella's double turn on
that
SmackDown.
That was sick. That was really, really well done. And that's why SmackDown is definitely the leader in the women's division.
Chris Jericho's heel turn on Styles on Raw. They had the Y2AJ thing for like 1 week. They had that unreal match with
for
New
1 week.
They had that great match with New Day for the tag team titles, and then Jericho just turned on him. That's a vintage, like, I don't know, high demand shirt right there.
Yeah. I wanna find this shirt. I literally want that shirt.
I love both of them.
Yeah.
AJ Styles here, true heel turn on Raw, honorable mention.
Yeah,
the John Cena.
Yep, and also the Usos heel turn, because of what it's done for their career,
even though they're injured right now.
Yeah,
but it was.
But the heel Usos are definitely
love heel Usos.
Awesome, unreal.
And Randy Orton's heel turn on SmackDown with the Wyatts is the winner this year.
Yep, winner Randy Orton turning with the Wise Men. I literally think that WWE didn't think it was supposed to go this way. I think they wanted to turn Randy Orton on Bray. It's just me. This is just me
like
thinking.
Like a couple weeks later.
And then they just saw how good it was. And they're like, shit, man, we need to keep this together. And then look what they did. They kept them together and they won the tag team titles. And it's been the best thing ever. Like, I actually like Randy Orton in the Wyatt family. It makes sense.
And look
now
what it's done for both of them.
Yeah.
Like, finally brought
Bray
Wyatt's
Wyatt finally got a title. He's finally got a title. And I think Randy Orton's is like a 4-time tag team champion.
So good for Randy Orton. Good turn, in my opinion.
Yeah. So let's get your responses out there for turn of the year. Colin Gambit, anyone, puts AJ Styles. Casey Salvas puts AJ Styles. Michael Chow puts Randy Wyatt. Agrees with us. Tyler Jones puts Triple H.
He was already technically heel.
Yeah, I guess the turn on Seth Rollins.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I agree with that. Good answer, Tyler Jones. Good answer. And then Tired of Relevance puts Randy Orton, so he agrees with us as well. That's such a good turn. I love it.
Technically, he turned Rollins' face by doing that. So yes. That kind of ties into our nomination.
It's almost like a double turn, almost.
Yeah. So, now we'll move into... Sorry, I'm on last year's awards. Let's not do that. All right.
Some good responses there.
Yeah. We'll go into... Let's do Tag Team of the Year, because it's such a unanimous award.
God.
Now,
if you guys don't get this award, I'm sorry. You need to look at it again from outside the box. Okay. Tag Teams of the Year nominees. The Wyatts. Slater and Rhino. Honorable mentions, this is our own Sheamus, the newly formed tag team. But the winner. The obvious choice at hand. The New Day.
Two-time winners.
And the longest reigning tag team champions in WWE history.
They have to
be the winners. If they didn't break it, I would have an argument here and there. But because they broke it, I definitely agree that the New Day should be tag team of the year.
There was,
100%.
There wasn't anyone even close.
No.
Like the Wyatts maybe now could be going towards
but
that. But
they weren't like
that
all year. The New Day were like this all year. And look
like
at that.
Going to last year, they won our award last year as well.
Jesus, 2 years in a row?
Yep, and
wow.
PTP first... and Lucha Dragons were the other nominations.
Oh, God. The Lucha Dragons.
But yeah, New Day, two-time NHBWP Slammy winners for Tag
Good
Team
for
of the Year. That's basically how long they've held the titles for.
Yep. Unanimously on Twitter, okay, I have Colin, anyone putting New Day. Casey Salvas. New Day. Tyler Jones, New Day. Michael Chow, the New Day, beat the tag team champions record and got cheered while being a heel team. Hashtag New Day rocks, and the gift just speaks for itself.
The booty shake.
And Tyler Relevance puts the top guys, the revival, hashtag fuck the New Day.
He hates the New Day.
Yeah. And Phil on Wrestling puts tag team of the year, Enzo and Cass.
I mean, as far as popularity,
maybe, but they haven't really done anything to be considered a tag team of the year.
Like, yeah, they're probably the most, I'd probably say they're still second to New Day for popularity.
Yeah, 100%.
Maybe next year they'll get
maybe next year, yeah. We'll see.
Next we'll move into debut of the year.
Ooh, debut.
Now let me make sure that we didn't have one of those for last year. No, we did not.
We did? I feel like we've done that before.
Return. We already did Return.
Oh, maybe I'm thinking of Return. I think I'm thinking of Return.
Yep.
But debut of the year goes to the best debut in that instance.
Yeah, not the whole year, just in their debut spot.
Yeah.
So our nominations were Finn Balor and his first Raw match, winning that Fatal 4-Way after being drafted to Raw.
Yep.
AJ really. Styles debuting at Royal Rumble, probably the biggest pop I've ever seen.
Yeah, and crazy. People knew that there was rumors that he was going to come to WWE, but him being in the Royal Rumble so early and then going up against Roman Reigns, people were like, what the fuck are we watching right now?
This is awesome. And Bayley.
Yep. Tagging with your girl Sasha Banks and then getting drafted after.
Enzo and Cass with the Dudleys after WrestleMania. What
just ripping them apart. Like the start of their... Everyone didn't think that they were going to be popular in the main roster. And I know they debuted them on the Raw after WrestleMania Crown, but that made sense. And it definitely was a good way to get them over. So,
yep.
Smart decision by WWE there.
And our winner is your boy, Baron Corbin.
What a debut. You guys think of it like this, and you guys are probably questioning me right now. But think about it. When did he debut? WrestleMania. What match? The Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. And he won it.
As an NXT superstar.
As an NXT superstar. What a fucking debut.
People that say AJ Styles, yeah, for the whole year, maybe. But not for that. Like, he didn't win the Rumble.
He didn't even win the Rumble. If he won the Rumble, yes. But he didn't. And, like, that was, like, there was no feud with him or anything. And I don't know.
No one expected Corbin to win.
No. No one ever, ever expected Corbin to win.
So, it's got to be Baron Corbin.
Yeah. But honorable mentions to AJ Styles. Your nominees out there. On Twitter, Colin Gamma Anyone puts Finn Balor. Okay, we can respect that. It's an honorable mention. He was a good debut.
Good nominee.
Casey Salvas puts AJ Styles. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Tyler Jones puts AJ Styles. Michael Chow puts AJ Styles. Loudest pop of the year. Beat up the Slammies. Tyler Owens puts Balor. And Phil on Wrestling puts debut of the year Enzo and Cass.
They were a nominee. But you guys got to look at it from Baron Corbin's perspective, though.
Yeah.
Like, the talent this guy has and the way he got called
the people
up.
He beat in that match. Did he eliminate Big Show to win that match? He picked him up and threw him over the top rope?
It was like Cesaro again.
Like,
hopefully he gets a better push than Cesaro.
No one expected Baron Corbin to win this match. He was just a random NXT person thrown in there.
And that starts off his career, which, I mean, he really hasn't done anything. They haven't given him a chance yet.
He's still being announced as the winner of the Andre the Giant. I know you get announced for the entire year, but
it's
like,
still a prestigious thing to win.
It is. It's almost like a mini Royal Rumble.
And it's at WrestleMania.
So I do think they should, like I said before in previous podcasts, they have to elevate that trophy. Maybe he gets a future title shot later down the line or something.
Yeah, they need to add something to that award. Yeah. I mean, he does come sometimes, that they do have it at ringside, but...
Or maybe, because it's a battle royal, at the following Royal Rumble, he gets to be, you know, enter number 30, or maybe he gets to be wherever he wants in the Rumble, except number 30.
I guess.
Something like that would make sense.
But... So, Baron Corbin, debut of the year.
Yeah.
Next, we're going to get into some funny categories. We're going to get into our favorites. Worst feud of the year.
Oh, God. There's been some great ones with this over the years, so let's hear these.
So, from 2014, our worst feud of the year was Fandango versus Santino Marella.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that was garbage.
They included poor Emma and Summer Rae in it.
Oh, my God.
With the Emma's Cobra thing.
And then Summer Rae being the dancer for Fandango.
Sweet Tea versus Brodus Clay.
Oh, my God. That was a feud? What the fuck is that? What?
Yeah, remember they were the tag team?
Tons of funk,
and then Brodus Clay was like, I'm the main event player, and then he turned on him.
Yeah, that was the worst thing on television. I'd rather see Kane versus the Milkman actually have a match than that shit.
And our winner that year was 3MB versus Los Matadores.
I hate Los Matadores. And I even hate their gimmick now, the Shining Stars. They're just cringe-worthy to me. I don't like seeing them.
Maybe they got Los Matadores a lifetime.
They get cringe of the year every single year, whatever gimmick they have.
Maybe Los Matadores was given a timeshare for the rest of their life. I don't know.
My God. Then,
for last year, the nominations were Stardust versus Neville, Rollins versus Sting, And the winner was Rusev and Ziggler. Remember that fucking love triangle?
Oh my god,
thing?
Yeah. That was so awkward. That's why it won, too. I think I remember saying that.
Yeah, it won. And then they ended up getting back together after, which, you know, made no sense.
It's almost like what happened now.
Now,
with the whole Enzo thing, but at least they turned it really quickly in the same episode.
Yeah, they didn't have Ziggler making out with Lana when you know she was Rusev's fiance.
Yeah, so we'll get into the nominations now.
Baron Corbin versus Kalisto.
Again, that was so bad because I ranted about it for weeks on end. And okay,
they had a good match.
The chairs match was like the
now good, they continued it
and they continued it after. So that's why it's considered a worst feud of the year. They should have ended it at the chairs match because it was a good ending, but then they continued it after.
Cesaro and Sheamus in the worst of seven series.
Yeah, we call it the worst, not the best, guys, the worst of seven series. This was the worst idea imaginable, but look what it's led to. Yeah, you can say that, but beforehand, what the fuck was this?
This was 2 months
was
of garbage.
Stupid.
Enzo and Cass versus the Dudleys.
Yeah,
I mean, it was a good debut for them.
Good debut
it
after
dragged.
It was just stale. It just became stale as bread. It was just fucking garbage. Croutons. It was garbage.
Speaking of garbage, our honorable mention, Golden Truth and the Shining Stars.
I can't even... They're not worthy of Worst Feud of the Year because it's garbage. It's just dumpster fire shit that no one... Who shows up to a Raw event and says, you know what? I'm looking forward to see Shining Stars and Golden Truth. Fuck Triple H. Fuck AJ Styles. What the fuck? Who's Kevin Owens? I don't even know what that is. I like Golden Truth. They're my pick. They're my favorite team.
I mean, I love Golden Truth. Like, shows to them for still being
But you don't
around.
Need to have a feud with another garbage dumpster fire tag team.
The Shining Stars just did not get over. And then they lost their spot in the match for Survivor Series because they sold them. Yep. R-Truth sold him his
and this
timeshare.
Did not win. Yes.
No.
This did not win.
There was something that was more significant as a worst feud, and that was Triple H and Roman Reigns.
And this was so bad. For one, Triple H did not need to come back, let alone win the fucking title at the Royal Rumble. Why did Triple H need to win the title?
And then they formed the whole League of Nations thing to basically take down Roman Reigns, or to make Roman Reigns look strong.
And it didn't. And they had no play in their WrestleMania match.
Because Sheamus.
And then Roman Reigns won against Triple H at WrestleMania. Shocker. Whoa. Big shocker there. That was like the most called match, the most predictable match in WWE history.
Terrible. People actually really wanted Triple H to still win.
Yeah. I remember we were watching that. And we were like, the crowd was cheering for Triple H. Like, that's how bad it is. That's how much they force feed Roman Reigns down our throats. It's because of that shit right there.
So Roman Reigns and Triple H gets our worst.
That gets worst feud of the year
because
right
it was the main event of WrestleMania.
How do you make a garbage match in a feud like that the match of WrestleMania? WrestleMania! How do you go from an epic finish to last year's WrestleMania to this hot garbage? Way to go, Vince. Way to make your granddaddy of them all a bowl of horse manure. Way to go.
Ooh, he accidentally speared Stephanie.
Ooh.
What did the Twitter fans say about this one?
Twitter fans, worst view of the year, put Colin Gamma, anyone, put Shining Stars and Golden Truth. Yeah, I can agree with that. 100%. Thank you, Colin. Casey Salvas puts Rusev versus Reigns. Okay, that was pretty bad, too. Michael Child puts Dummy Brand Titus O'Neil versus Please Take Every Day Off Darren Young. Hashtag the prime time dumpster fire. Oh, man.
I don't even want to think about that feud.
Tyler Ellens puts history. Okay.
All right.
I don't know what that means, but okay. Phil on Wrestling puts worst feud of the year, Triple H and Roman Reigns. He agrees with us. That
hates
was so bad.
Triple H, though. Let's just say that.
And when he became champion, I remember No Self Phil was so mad.
He wasn't even there for WrestleMania. Thank God. He said he would have been shit.
Yeah, but he was there for the Royal Rumble when he won the title.
Oh, yeah. He was so happy about that. Now we'll get on to the second part of that and worst match of the year.
Oh, my God. Yep.
And we definitely have awards for that. That's one of our longest reigning awards.
God.
So we've got worst match of the year from 2014, Rusev versus Big Show.
Wow, what a match.
Big Show versus Brock Lesnar at Royal Rumble.
Oh my God. And we thought it was going to be good like their previous matches. No, that was just god awful.
And the winner was the WLC match with Hornswoggle and El
Torito. Oh my God, yeah, who the hell? Oh my God. I didn't even know what that was. I remember watching that match and going, what am I actually watching here? Is this Cirque du Soleil? Like, what the fuck am I watching?
That was just... That was not right.
No. It wasn't. I think it was discriminating, okay?
And last year was Tommy Dreamer versus Braun Strowman.
What, that happened?
Yep. When they had the whole Wyatt's versus the Hardcore Legends.
Oh, my God, yeah. God, I totally forgot about that. And Rhino was part of that, and then he left after, then came back.
Ziggler versus Tyler Breeze, because they rushed and ruined that feud. Yeah. It could have been such a great
feud. That could have been sick. I was begging for a hair versus hair match. That would have been sick.
And the winner last year was Big Show and Ryback.
Whoa. Oh, yeah. That was a TLC. That was so bad.
The stairs match.
God, that was so bad.
But no, it was the feud leading up to the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. Remember that?
Oh, yeah. That's just
terrible storylining by both of them. Luckily, this year, Big Show was not in any of the worst
matches.
And
luckily, these were semi-better. I guess WWE's getting better that we're going to have less and less worst match of the year.
Big Show was not around this year.
Yay! So. It wasn't even in a category, but Strowman was.
All right, let's go right into it. We got the Headbangers versus the Usos, your boys, on SmackDown. We won't have anything else to say about that. Braun Strowman versus any of the local jobber matches.
Yeah, those are just god-awful. We didn't need to see those. They're just pointless for TV.
Brock Lesnar versus Randy Orton in Survivor Series because of the way it ended.
Yeah.
They had the feud leading up was great. They actually got us excited about it.
But then, the match was just garbage. The stupid UFC elbow that ended
the
match.
That was the main event of SummerSlam.
That was the main event of SummerSlam. You're trying to make it like a big four pay-per-view and trying to make it as big as WrestleMania.
And you have Lesnar just...
And you ended it like that.
Have Orton in a bloodbath to end the thing.
Sick.
And another match that, with Lesnar, that was hype that turned out to be shit was Dean Ambrose versus Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania.
Yeah, that's supposed to be this hardcore man. Like, Dean Ambrose had all these weapons given from all the legends, and we really wanted Raven to give him the shopping cart, and that never fucking happened. And then it just ended up being the worst hardcore match I've ever seen ever.
And
they used chairs. Ooh,
and wow. And you listen to Stone Cold's podcast. Apparently, Ambrose wanted to do more, but Lesnar was not interested, according to that.
Oh, fuck Brock Lesnar.
Honorable mention, actually, not. We won't go to the honorable mention yet. We have another one that I just added because it was this week. We had the Tussle in Texas match between Mark Henry and Titus O'Neil. The fact that they named it. An actual like type of match,
and it was shorter than Goldberg's squash match. It
might have been the shortest match of the year. I think it might have been shorter than the Braun Strowman local jobber match.
I think so. I literally think this was so short. Like, and this was Titus O'Neil and Mark Henry,
and you had Titus backstage handing out flyers for this match
that lasted 6 seconds.
The Tussle.
Titus O'Neil handing out flyers lasted longer than the match itself.
And our honorable mention, it would have won. But the problem is it did not actually start in a match. We had that atrocious segment of Kane versus Carrie the Milkman Millman.
What?
The fact that they took time away from an AJ Styles Apollo Crews match for this and before the main event started, they had to add this in there for 5 minutes.
This, I think they, I hope they fired the guy who thought of that on SmackDown because we haven't seen shit like that since. So thank fucking Christ we don't see Gary
and
the Milkman Millman
anymore.
It led
to nothing. It didn't lead to anything for Kane either.
No. And Kane's just cringeworthy too. He needs to stay off TV as well.
Why did he have to strip down to his underwear?
We're going to add a moment next year. We're going to add another word, cringeworthy of the year, cringe superstar of the year.
Honorable mention. If you can call them winners, the Kane and Gary the Milkman Millman. But the winner of the year...
Worst
match of the year. We debated this a little bit. Natalya versus Charlotte at Money in the Bank.
This was the worst women's match I've ever seen. Like,
it's up there with, like, the crappy era.
I put this match in that era because it was just bad. I felt like I was watching a women's match from that era. I'm like, this is terrible. What, women's revolution? What? I can't believe this should be like a blemish on Charlotte's pay-per-view record because this was just bad.
They had Natty with Bret Hart and Ric Flair with Charlotte. And Charlotte had Natty in I think it was the figure eight.
Yeah.
And for some reason, Charles Robinson just rings the bell. Like, for no reason.
Why does Charles Robinson all of a sudden become a heel referee? I would make sense if it was Chad Patton. Is that his name?
No, Nick Patrick.
Nick Patrick, if he was out there.
Or Scott Armstrong.
Or Scott Armstrong.
But, like, why did this match have to end like that? And then they had the storyline the week later with Charles Robinson saying he's always been a Ric Flair fan. It's like, where did this come from?
Like, it didn't make any sense.
Why would he do this now? Ric Flair's been back with the company for, like, 16 years.
And that ruined the whole match. I'm like, this is just god-awful. They really didn't need to do that, and they did.
That was so bad. The way that it ended, that's why it went worst match of the year for me.
100%. So let's get your Twitter responses out there. What do you guys think the worst match of the year was? Cullen, Gamma NU1 puts Brock versus Orton at SummerSlam. Yep, we definitely agree with you with that one. That was really bad. Casey Salas puts Titus versus Darren Young. I guess he needs any match with that. Yep. Michael Chell's an interesting one. Mike, I totally forgot about it until Michael Chell tweeted it. The Rock versus Eric Rowan at WrestleMania. If you thought Lesnar Goldberg was short, 6 seconds, seriously, hashtag part-time match.
I still don't even consider that a match.
It was a match. The bell rung, I know, there was a pinfall.
But, like, my God.
It was that, basically just hyping. We have to time Rock and see which match was longer. The Rock versus Eric Rowan or the Tussle in Texas match. We need to see which one was longer. And see what the shortest match of the year was.
It's going to be pretty fucking close, yeah. Man. But yeah, I can see it now. I agree with you, Michael Chow, that it should be up there because it was a match.
And Tyler Ellis just puts revolutionary. I don't even know what that means.
I don't know where he's going with these.
Were you just tired, like your title? You put Tyler. Were you just tired and didn't? I don't understand.
Thanks for your input, Irrelevant.
Yeah, thanks, though.
Did I already say worst match? Yeah, we did.
Yes, right? We
Big
did.
Show and Rival. So shout outs to Big Show for not being involved in
this good year. For you, man. We can appreciate that.
Next, we're getting into the good ones now.
Ooh.
We'll get into, female rookie of the year.
Ooh, female rookie of the year. All right.
In 2014, we just did rookie. We didn't do female or male.
Okay.
But I'm going to say it because it was a female that won it. Okay. So in 2014, our nominations were Adam Rose. My God. Look where he went.
Oh.
Rusev. Good nomination. And Paige won the award for 2014.
Yeah. My girl Paige, having the NXT Women's Championship and the Divas Championship at the same time. Maybe she can get back to that. I hope so. She comes back from this neck injury.
Yeah, and the other one last year was male, so I'll announce that for male. Female Rookie of the Year, Carmella was a nomination. She's done a fantastic job since she's been called up to SmackDown. She's been a great heel. I think she's been getting...
Her and Nikki feud have been like... That's probably the SmackDown feud of the year since the brand split. This has been the best feud going on
and
SmackDown.
I guess now it's leading to the Carmella and Natalya thing.
For some reason.
Carmella has been overshadowed, I think, a little bit by Alexa. I mean, I think Alexa's been...
Think it's going to be leading to Mickie James when she gets called up to SmackDown.
But Carmella has done a very underrated job as a fantastic heel woman 100%. On SmackDown.
Baymella, baby.
Bayley, she hasn't done much, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Haven't used her yet.
Yeah, not to her full potential. They're just like they're slowly pushing her in and grazing her to become the next.
I mean, I don't mind that they're kind of doing a slow build with Bayley. Maybe it leads to a WrestleMania match.
Yeah,
maybe her crowning moment there. So I expect her to be in the conversation for NXT Woman of the Year main roster Woman of the Year next year. Nia Jax,
really tough not to pick her, man. She's just been dominant since coming up, man. Like, it's just been nuts with the jobbers and then, like, clobbered everyone at Survivor Series. Just ran over everybody.
That was nuts when we saw that live.
Yeah.
I know you're going to hate this one, but Dana Botch, Dana Brooke.
Play time is over for Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, her nomination is over. We're not going to talk about her anymore.
Yeah, she needs to go back to NXT.
And Ari winner, this is like my favorite winner of the year. I want to talk about this. Alexa Bliss.
Yeah.
She deserves this more than anyone deserves.
And this has to be unanimous with you guys out there. She's got to be the Rookie of the Year.
Look at I just want to talk about how she started in NXT and where she's come. She was never given a shot in NXT as a singles competitor. She was always with fucking Blake and Murphy and being their manager. She was never given a proper shot to show what she could do in a singles division. And since she's been called up, I don't think anyone ever expected her to be where she's at now when the brand split happened.
I honestly think she's slowly, if not becoming, the greatest heel, one of the greatest heel women in the division.
She is right behind Charlotte if she's not better. And she's only been there for
months. The history of heel women wrestlers, she's one of the best. It's only been like half a year.
It reminds me of that heel Trish Stratus, like her mannerisms, the way she carries herself. Her facial expressions are fantastic.
Oh my God, it's just they're on point. Like, she's good.
Such a good heel. I love it. And honestly, if she was there the whole year, I would have given her not even just rookie. I would have given her female of the year 100%.
Oh wow,
like it wouldn't even been close. She is the best woman in the company right now.
Doing I agree. The best work. I can. Not agree with you. I can't disagree with you.
I mean, well, I want to see what she can do with the title now. I mean, last week was pretty stale with that championship ceremony thing.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping she builds from that, and I could see her being a very dominant woman's champion on SmackDown. So Alexa Bliss, well deserved to my girl.
Yeah, Alexa Bliss.
Female Rookie of the Year, your Twitter responses out there. Cullen puts Alexa. Hootran, Alexa. Casey, Alexa. Tyler Jones, Bailey. What a B-A-E. That's a biased pick. I can appreciate that.
I can't.
Michael Chow puts Alexa Bliss, 47th draft pick, is now women's champion.
Hey.
Success is Bliss.
Hey, he's on the Bliss train with me.
Yeah.
I know it.
Tired of Relevance, Alexa Bliss. And Phil on Wrestling puts Bailey for female rookie of the year.
Bailey's the most popular, but she hasn't done anything yet.
Yeah, not yet. I'm a huge Bailey supporter, so I can agree with that.
She doesn't deserve it now.
And I pick Alexa Bliss. I picked Alexa Bliss 100%.
Hey, remember my tweet when I said undisputed steal of the draft?
Yep.
Now look at it.
Yep.
So shout outs to Alexa Bliss for winning that award. Next, we'll go into male
rookie of the year.
And last year, our nominees were Neville. Fuck, poor guy.
Yeah.
Kalisto. And the unanimous winner was Kevin Owens.
Yeah. And it makes sense. Look what he did last year with the whole Cena rivalry and what he did after that, man. It's nuts. So get into the nominees for this year's Male Rookie of the Year. We got Baron Corbin, my boy Baron Corbin. Since winning the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal and debuting there and what he's done since then, it sucks because he's never gotten the big push that he deserves, but I think he's definitely honorable mention for Rookie of the Year because he just dominates anyone that they put in front of him, and he's got one of the greatest finishers I've ever seen. So
the End of Days is probably the best finisher in WWE, if not, my personal opinion, the Phenomenal Forearms is my favorite.
Yeah, it's pretty good. So I guess he's definitely a nominee,
Baron Corbin,
for sure.
Man, and I really wish they would do more with him.
Yeah. Enzo and Cass.
I think everybody realizes how much potential Baron Corbin has. As like a top heel.
Yeah.
The guy's just oozing with that top heel talent.
He just needs that. They need to put someone in front of him. He needs a good feud because he's ready for it. It's not like he's not ready for it.
Maybe
he's ready.
He could even be a Paul Heyman guy.
That'd be sick. I really hope that happens, man. I'm thinking about that now. That would be unreal.
So, yeah, sorry. The next nomination.
Enzo and Cass. Yes and no. Yes, because
They're the most popular tag.
They're popular because no one thought that they were going to be this popular being called up. People thought they weren't going to go with it. And you look at that one Raw where they had the entire Raw crowd
doing his promo with Elvis Mike. Remember that?
Yeah, because the club took it out. So, you know, that's a respectable nominee.
And they are a very big addition for WWE as far as popularity. They do a lot of events for them now and a lot of those stupid promo things with the Christmas.
Yeah.
And the Christmas promotion.
Oh, God,
stuff.
Yeah.
So.
And just with this, I guess that whole rated R kind of thing they did last, right? It's gotten a lot of love after that. So, whatever. People are like, oh, Attitude Era 2.0. Next nominee. Finn Balor, I mean, it sucks because he's been hurt for half the year, but definitely
in the 2 weeks that he was there.
Yeah, unreal. Like that's about a month leading into the Dean Ambrose feud. So, I mean, it was sick. And I think Balor can have an incredible year next year when he's fully healthy and hopefully he stays healthy. Hopefully they don't do any more spots like they just did to him.
The first ever Universal champion.
Yeah. Good for Finn Balor. He's going to be sick.
Yeah.
I hope they watch out and not do anything to that shoulder anymore after this.
Seth Rollins, no more of that spot, man.
No. I don't think they should feud Seth Rollins after that. Maybe put him on SmackDown.
Maybe.
No. Last nominee, Sami Zayn. Before we announce our winner, Sami Zayn. Definitely could be considered Rookie of the Year.
Just wish they would do more with him.
Yeah, had Match of the Year. Nakamura gets called up. He's just another guy who's oozing with talent who WWE doesn't know what to do with. And he needs that feud. I think he's main event level ready now. He can go for that. I think he should be the winner of the Royal Rumble this year. And we'll get into that when we get into next month's Royal Rumble predictions. I think he should be the one to win it this year. Mm-hmm. And be at least, if they're going to do a triple threat at WrestleMania, or if he's going to get traded to SmackDown, have him compete for the WWE World Title. Why not? He 100% deserves it and can go and be that underdog win. And you know, you don't have to have it for the Universal Title. You can make Vince can have his big giant ego and make the Universal Championship the main event. Or if you're going to fucking bring out Brock Lesnar for some gay shit like that, whatever. Just at least if you're going to make the co-main event or the co-co main event, the WWE World Title, have Sami Zayn win it. Why not? I think that can definitely go over the WrestleMania crowd. And he could be a decent champion.
I think
he's ready for it.
I think he would be main event quality, but I think more realistic. I could see him in a great feud with Miz for that IC title if he goes to SmackDown.
That'd be
to
sick.
Continue that feud that they had when they only had that one match and Maryse fucked the match over.
That definitely, for sure, 100%. I can even see that happening, but I think they're going to be continuing with the whole IC title
and now
WrestleMania maybe match.
He could beat Braun Strowman, but I doubt it. They might have that as a huge underdog story. But
maybe. That'd be sick. He beats Braun Strowman and wins the Royal Rumble. Who knows?
Maybe
it's Braun Strowman and Sami Zayn, the last two in the Royal Rumble. AJ Styles is our winner, though, for Rookie of the Year.
You always forget that he's a rookie.
Yeah.
Because technically he's a rookie in WWE. Because
he started in January. Yeah. And it feels like he's not, because it's been a full, almost a full year since he's debuted in WWE. And look what he's done. Since his debut, what he's accomplished in the WWE, beating Chris Jericho at he lost Chris Jericho at WrestleMania, whatever. I think he won in the rematch, though. He went on he faced Roman Reigns. He had one of the feuds of the year with John Cena and one of the matches of the year with John Cena at SummerSlam. He won a WWE World title from Dean Ambrose at, was it, the first ever SmackDown branded pay-per-view.
It was Backlash.
And he still kept the title since then. And look what he's done. I mean, he's lost to James Ellsworth, but...
But he has become a great top heel for
and that company. Epic TLC match he had with SmackDown. Ambrose. Yeah, he carries SmackDown over the top to the point where he injured his ankle at TLC because he's just a fucking phenomenal superstar, no pun intended. And that 450 splash he did from the top rope was just incredible.
He's the best wrestler in the company.
Yeah, so I think definitely, unanimously, should be Rookie of the Year, 100%. I think
people might forget that he's a rookie, but he technically is a WWE rookie.
Yeah. And we'll get into our male rookie of the year on Twitter. And Colin, GammaNU1, puts, I guess AJ if he's considered a rookie. Yes, he is considered a rookie, Colin. Good for you. Casey Salvas puts AJ. Tyler Jones puts AJ. Michael Chow, AJ has accomplished so much in a rookie year. Best I've seen since Kurt Angle. # beat up slammies. Tyler Relevance puts Baron Corbin. All right. Yes, I love you. I love you. Puts my boy Baron Corbin first over AJ Styles. Biasly, yes, I agree, but I actually have to go with AJ Styles in this one, tired of relevance. And Phil on Wrestling, male rookie of the year. I do not know what your logic behind this pick was. Apollo Crews.
If you want to talk about buried rookie.
Like, how is he rookie of the year? What has he done?
I think that was that. I hope that was a joke.
I hope that was a joke.
maybe it was a shot at you because he knows you love Apollo Crews.
Yeah, probably.
But,
we'll move on.
Next, we'll get into Female Superstar of the Year.
Ooh. Nominees.
Last year's nominations were Charlotte, Paige, and Nikki Bella, and the winner was Nikki Bella. Because of her longest reigning championship feud. I know you don't like it.
I can't believe you voted for that.
But Nikki Bella was the winner last year.
At least she's not in it this year.
And our nominations this year... Becky Lynch, Charlotte, Alexa Bliss, who has just come out of nowhere to be even involved in this conversation, and Sasha Banks.
So this was really another one we discussed for a while.
For obvious reasons, look at
the nominations. How can you seriously sit there and say, oh, right off the page, this person? No, because every one of these people has something behind them that can be considered.
One of them.
Yeah. So after much debate. Much shocking.
Unfortunately,
we did not go with any of Corporate Cappy's girls or No Self Phil's girl. We went with Charlotte. Just literally won by a slim margin, and we're given that slim margin because she's been undefeated at pay-per-views, and that's something that's don't think it's ever been done in the women's division ever.
And I honestly, we expect her to win it, the title back at Roadblock this Sunday.
Yeah, and then be undefeated from January till December, a whole full year. Without being defeated.
I mean, you can't argue with Charlotte, man. She's the best heel in the company. I think Sasha could be the best heel if they gave her a heel run.
Yeah.
But right now, Charlotte is the best heel in the company. She's elevated herself to be not just Ric Flair's daughter. She's her own person and her own.
Oh, yeah, for sure. 100%. I 100% agree. And just what she's portrayed as this whole gimmick of the queen is just, it's so good.
And you just look at her.
It's
she's just
so
a
good.
Genetic freak.
It's
you just
great.
Look at her.
She's such a, and she's an, like, don't get us wrong, she's an exceptional athlete. Like, she's really, really good. And she's.
Her moonsaults and shit off.
It's not like I don't want her in the division. I want her in the division. She brings so much to the table. Like, you can hate her, character, but like.
I can appreciate her. There are people that are already saying that Charlotte is the best woman of all time.
I mean, I wouldn't go that far.
I wouldn't go that far either, but I can see where they're coming from. Charlotte deserves to be female, the superstar of the year. Unfortunately, that breaks my heart to say that about Sasha and Becky. I mean, not Becky, my God, Alexa. Fuck Becky. So, yeah. What did the Twitter fans say?
Twitter fans for female of the year. Oop, I put female rookie. Female superstar of the year. Twitter fans put Cullen, put Gamma NU1 Charlotte. Who trained Superman? Charlotte. Casey Salvis, Sasha Banks.
Yeah.
Tyler Jones, Sasha Banks. Michael Chow, Charlotte, undefeated pay-per-view streak, best female on the mic, second pick in the draft, hashtag bow down to your slammy queen. Tyrell Evans, blue pants. Okay, that's a relevant pick right there from Irrelevance himself. And Phil on Wrestling puts Charlotte. Blue pants, really?
Blue pants. You got to give a shout out to Sasha, though. I mean, without Sasha, yeah, there's an no
honorable
Charlotte.
Mentions to Sasha Banks.
They, 100%. They make each other better.
Yeah.
So, except now the future is redundant.
Yeah.
But now we'll move into. Let's go with move of the year.
Move of the year. Okay, guys. You guys had some confusion with this too on Twitter. Move of the year. We're trying to say like what was an incredible move from a certain match that was like
spot.
A spot.
Yeah.
Like, we could have called it spot of the year, but like we didn't mean like who has the best move, like the finishing move, and that's what a lot of you guys thought. But we meant like. You just listen to our nominees and you'll know what we're talking about.
Next year we'll rebrand it as spot of the year.
So, nominees.
We've got, from last year.
Last year, ooh.
Last year's move of the year, we had Cena. Wait, what? Oh, that's a match. Move of the year, here we go. Randy Orton's RKO WrestleMania to Seth Rollins.
Yeah, that was sick. Yep.
When he tried to go for the curb stomp, Orton jumped up.
Yep.
Bayley's Franken Bayley to Sasha at NXT Brooklyn.
God, that was sick.
I don't even know what to say to that. And the winner was Kalisto Salida del Sol at TLC off the ladder onto the other ladder. Yeah, that was crazy.
That one, right?
That was the winner.
That was insane. That was a last minute of war too. Like that was
that just
came right
got
before
in time. And so this year's nominees are. You love this move, the Cesaro springboard uppercut off the ladder to Kevin Owens at Money in the Bank.
If you guys haven't seen this, literally just Google what he just said. Cesaro springboard uppercut to Owens, and it's the first videos that show up there at Money in the Bank. And literally he jumps from the ladder, from the top rope, and twirls around and uppercuts Kevin Owens. It's the sickest move I've ever seen. Like, that's just, it's so smooth and clean.
From a guy that big like Cesaro, you can't like.
And it's just, he did it with such execution finesse. And just, it was perfect. And that's why I think it was a move of the year, 100%. And I remember since that day I wrote it down, like, this has to be a move of the year.
It's in there.
Yeah.
The Shield triple powerbomb to the announced AJ Styles.
That's just because of the nostalgia of them reuniting for that one spot. Yeah.
Randy Orton's RKO to Seth Rollins at Survivor Series.
Yeah, that was sick. That was just incredible. It's up there with, it's almost like the Rollins one at WrestleMania.
You can go with any of these, really. AJ Styles 450 splash to Ambrose
off
the top
rope through
a table at TLC.
So sick. It was and it's through a table, too. Like, I mean, on the outside, you put all those factors together and going, that's a holy shit moment right there.
And our winner of the year for move of the year is Shane O'Mac's elbow drop onto the Undertaker.
Like, that's at his age, at this point in time, you wouldn't think he was going to be able to do that. Everyone was talking about it before this match. Like, is he going to do it? Is he not going to do it? Oh no, Undertaker's too old and Shane's too old. They can't do a move like that. And they fucking did it. They did it. I couldn't. We were going nuts here at my house when that happened. We were
like,
losing our
dead?
Shit. We dead? Thought they were dead, man. Like. That's why it wins move of the year, 100%. Like, for those two guys to do this at this point in their lives is just, you have to, like, hats off to
props.
Them. Man.
And then Shane O'Mac coming out the next night, like, limping, and the crowd
and
was saying,
still
like,
here.
Thank you, Shane. Thank you,
Shane. Yeah, Taker's still here. I mean, he had hip surgery, not from that match, but he's still here.
That was a phenomenal move of the year.
So we'll go into your Twitter responses. I know this didn't really make sense, but it's okay, guys. Colin put coup de grace. It is a sick finisher, though. I'll give him that. Tyler Jones put whatever Braun's new finisher is.
Wow, really?
The backwards joke slam.
It's only three.
That's
finishers.
A bias. Michael Chow put Charlotte's corkscrew moonsault from the top rope to the outside of the ring. Hashtag holy shit, holy shit.
That was a good move.
That was a sick move, I'll admit. Like, literally, it's almost like a Falcon Arrow, or not Falcon Arrow, a Phoenix Splash. And It took both those superstars to execute it well and Sasha to catch her at the right time. So it was definitely really well done. And I thought that's up there for move of the year. Tyrell Owens puts End of Days. That's such a sick finisher. I love it. And Phil on Wrestling puts Move of the Year, that freaking spin kick Mickie James did on Asuka. Holy moly.
I don't even remember that.
I have to go back and look at that because he wrote that and I meant to go look at it before the show and I didn't. But sorry, Phil. I'll have to go back and look at that. But
thanks for the off the script pick there, Phil. All right. Now we're getting into some of the final awards here. We're getting into the
moment.
Yeah, moment in the moment of the year. We had one for not 2014. Last year we had one.
Moment.
We had Sheamus's cash in at Survivor Series.
I wouldn't consider that a moment now.
Not now, but at the time.
Oh yeah, yeah, I remember. Yeah, they copied Daniel Bryan. Like, yeah.
NWO and DX confrontation at WrestleMania.
That was sick. Yeah, that's a moment of the year.
And our winner was The Rock and Ronda Rousey.
Yeah, God, that was sick.
That was a bad year for moments, man.
Yeah, it was. This year was even better.
They're all part-timers.
I know. this year, there's some, too.
This year, luckily, there's a lot more. Our nominations were Triple H as the number 30 entrant in the Royal Rumble, and then going on to win the match.
God, it's a bad moment, but it was a moment. Like, some we didn't agree with, but whatever. It was a moment, and some we wouldn't think happened, and it happened.
And they wanted him to not get huge pop by eliminating Roman Reigns, so they had Reigns go out second last, and they had Ambrose and Triple H as the last team.
Yeah.
Sasha Banks winning her first WWE Women's Championship on Raw, and the first Raw, the brand extension. Like, what a start to the brand extension.
That's an incredible, and no one would have thought that she would have won it on Raw. People thought that, okay, they're probably going to wait till the next WrestleMania to have her win it. No, like, and now she's been three times on Raw.
No, she's only going to win on Raw, guys. So that was a very moment that was very dear to my heart. Dean Ambrose cashing in Money in the Bank to win the WWE World title on the same night.
In the same night. That was crazy. And just from a guy like Dean Ambrose.
Finally winning his first WWE title.
That was sick. Just, it was unreal. And what a way to do it. And like the three Shield members all interacting with it.
Yeah,
so
they all had it.
Rollins beating Reigns for the title, and then Ambrose cashing in on Rollins. Like, that was crazy.
Yeah, it was a crazy. So I think they actually have a plaque on the shop for all three of them.
I think so, yeah.
It's an expensive plaque. Kevin Owens winning the Universal title.
Yeah.
Thanks to the help of Triple H turning on Rollins.
Kevin Owens, baby,
Rollins.
And still champ. Hopefully
that was
past Sunday.
That was a crazy moment. The fact that Triple H came out from the crowd and just pedigreed Roman Reigns and got in the ring. And
then just everyone just like, what the fuck? Did he just turn on Rollins?
About to help Kevin or help Rollins put Kevin Owens in the pedigree. Turns around, gives Rollins the pedigree.
That was insane. And that's an honorable mention because this was tough. But we went with this one and it was something we saw live.
The Goldberg squashing Brock Lesnar in under 2 minutes.
It's definitely moment of the year because no one saw that coming.
It's like Undertaker in the streak.
It was like 45 minutes before the pay-per-view was even done. So like we you couldn't have seen that coming at all.
The fact that Brock Lesnar broke the streak, had one of the most dominant championship matches against John Cena in history.
And agrees to this.
Gets squashed.
It's beyond me. Like that.
I mean, I know
spear
there's a lot
twice and a jackhammer and then done.
I understand.
He didn't do a F5 or anything. There was nothing.
I understand why there's a lot of backlash for this. But
we found out after.
It still is.
Goldberg
like,
was hurt. And they're going to have their rematch. It's going to be WrestleMania. Everyone calm their shit.
At the moment in time, everyone was just like, what just happened?
Yeah. Everyone in the stands were standing still and going, like, is it done? Like, is something going to happen here?
Nope.
And like, Goldberg starts celebrating when the kids were like, oh my God, this is over. Like, is this actually done?
That was just insane.
Yeah. And that's why we voted it the moment of the year. We'll go to your Twitter responses out there. Cullen at GammaN1 puts Shane O'Mac jumping off the cell. That's a pretty good one. We'll agree with you there. That was definitely in our move of the year. Tired of Relevance puts Triple H's betrayal to Rollins. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. That ties into the Kevin Owens thing. Who Trans Superman puts the Miz talking smack promo.
Mm-hmm.
And he also puts Scotland singing for 10 minutes straight to Bailey interrupting Charlotte. That was great. Casey Styles puts AJ Styles heel turns. So that's his moment of the year. Okay. Michael Chow puts Triple H returns to screw over Seth Rollins. Hashtag game over. And he puts the freaking out Seth Rollins.
I mean, yeah, as Rollins, like, Rollins was his like, baby boy, gave him his finisher, and then he just turned on him like that.
Phil's is interesting. Phil's moment of the year was when Shane McMahon returns. He jumped out of his seat for this, and I remember he did jump out of the... It was my couch. He jumped out of his seat for that, so... That's his moment of the year. Interesting. So I love your moments of the year, guys. You guys are definitely different, unique.
Yep.
We love it. We love your responses.
Getting down to the final three awards here.
Here we go.
We've got Male Superstar of the Year.
Mm. This is a toughie.
Very tough.
Ladies and gentlemen, very, very tough. Nominees are...
Hang on. We got
oh, we got, oh yeah, we have year. The ones from 2 years ago.
2014, when No Sell Phil was still a part of the show, he said Seth Rollins.
Ooh.
I said Brock Lesnar because he broke the streak.
Yeah.
And then you said Dean Ambrose.
I did? Dean Ambrose? Wow. Yep. That's crazy, eh?
And last year, our nominations were Roman Reigns, Kevin Owens, and Seth Rollins, and the winner was Seth Rollins because of the year he had last year.
Yeah. 100% agree with that.
This year,
Rollins is not even a nominee.
Nope.
We have Dean Ambrose, my boy, KO, Kevin Owens, AJ Styles, Roman Reigns,
and Chris Jericho.
So you can see how tough this was for us. And after lots and lots of debating, we finally picked one. And it's got to go to a guy. You just got
to drink it in.
You just have to drink it in, man.
Chris Jericho
is definitely superstar of the year.
Yeah, he didn't win a title.
And yeah, it's only jumped for half a year, but this is definitely the best work he's ever had in his entire career, and he only did it in 4 months.
And this is the most over thing on TV right
now. And he's just incredible. I don't know why they didn't... You know what? I would have put a major title on him, or at least a minor card title.
He should have won the U.S. title from Roman Reigns
last week. Well, we said 2 weeks ago, or last week, he should have won the U.S. title from Roman Reigns. It would have made more sense, and he definitely deserves it. So, you know what? Chris Jericho, epic to win Superstar of the Year without even winning a title in that entire year.
Anyone comeback Superstar of the Year.
Yeah, comeback Superstar of the Year. So good for Chris Jericho, man. Chris
Jericho deserves it.
He's been the guy this year. Literally, he's been the savior of WWE this entire year.
Especially of Raw. Raw's been garbage.
Yeah, 100%. Brand split. Yeah,
he has helped it with Kevin Owens and their whole storyline thing. And the list, stupid idiot chants, the drink it in, man, turning into every kind of drinking it in thing you can think of.
Upping the Jeritron to 6,500, whatever it is now. Like, every week he comes up with better and better and better material, and he's never dry. And a guy to do that at this time and age and still be kind of considered part-time, but he's actually wrestling on a full-time basis, is just amazing.
He never lost baby.
And that's why he should be Male Superstar of the Year, 100%.
Congratulations to Chris Jericho. Yeah. We never thought we would be saying that in 2016.
No. If you had came to me last year, at the beginning of last year, and said that next year Chris Jericho will be Male Superstar of the Year, I would have laughed at you and punched you in the face.
You had 8 heads.
Yep. I would have been like, what?
Huh? Who? What's up with that?
Who? So, your Twitter responses out there, Male Superstar of the Year. Colin puts, and finally, as long as I didn't fuck up any more votes, Chris Jericho. Michael Chow simply puts, year it in, man.
Okay.
He puts Chris Jericho. Who Chains Superman puts Chris Jericho and The Miz? We gave 2 answers. He couldn't decide. Interesting. I'd say The Miz is a good answer. I wouldn't say Superstar of the Year, but he's definitely, again, a comeback talk for sure. Casey Salas puts AJ Styles. That's a good pick. I mean,
I know.
Look what he's done since the Royal Rumble. It's incredible. Tyler Jones puts Jericho. So good for Tyler Jones agreeing with us there. Tyra Relevance puts performance wise AJ, comedy Chris Jericho, improvement Miz. Okay. That's a really good answer. I like that.
That's a good way to break it down, I guess.
Yeah. Phil on Wrestling puts Chris Jericho as well.
So,
yeah.
A lot of them agreeing with Chris Jericho.
Yep.
You can't dispute it.
And you can't, and the people that says Styles out there. You can't dispute that either. What he's done since the beginning to now, but then he's also a rookie, so that's why we couldn't consider him a Superstar of the Year. We would have considered him both, but we wanted to put a different pick for Superstar of the Year.
We have not seen the end of AJ Styles yet this year, for this video.
Yeah.
Next, we will get into Feud of the Year, second last of...
Feud of the Year for the main roster.
So Feud of the Year for 2014, we had Evolution versus The Shield. John Cena versus Brock Lesnar and Daniel Bryan versus The Authority.
2014. That was back when Lesnar first came back. God, man, it's only been 2 years. That's incredible.
And look what he's done in 2 years.
Yeah,
Daniel Bryan versus The Authority won for 2014.
Yeah. Oh, that was 100% the Feud of the Year. You can't argue with that.
Nope. Just the way it ended too.
Yeah.
Feud of the Year last year we had Rollins versus Reigns, Cena versus Rusev, and the winner was Lesnar and Undertaker.
God, Cena versus Rusev. Yeah, I agree with that.
Nominations this year we've got New Day versus the Wyatt Family, which was beginning of the year feud. Remember when Xavier Woods was like petrified from the Wyatts? That was cool.
That was actually sick, and then they ended it really quick
League of Nations
whatever.
Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens, fantastic,
unreal, guys could fight forever. I wouldn't even mind a feud forever. I know I said I would, but like, you know what?
They continue from NXT.
So good. So
they,
good.
And they've wrestled each other so many times, they just, it's just like nothing.
They,
comes second
they
nature
just
to
put
them.
Every match they have. You know, it's a good feud when every match they have is an incredible match.
And I compare it to this one, Miz and Ziggler, same thing. They yep. always have a good yep. match. Miz and Ziggler has got to be in feud of the year as well.
That's an, yeah.
yeah. AJ Styles versus John Cena, fantastic.
Honorable mention, because that was incredible.
The promos they had, breaking the fourth wall with
these the club, too. And the, oh, man, that was just that whole summer this year of AJ Styles in the club and John Cena breaking the fourth wall and then their feud leading to SummerSlam was unreal. It was so good. So good.
Don't worry, we haven't heard the end of that. But and our winner, we've debated this. And you guys can disagree with us, but we are going to say Sasha Banks versus Charlotte sure. as yeah. feud of the year up until Hell in a Cell.
Hell in a Cell. 100%. And that's actually his vote, ladies and gentlemen. We actually had two winners.
Oh, yeah,
winners.
We did have two votes. Yes,
that's who he's picking, Charlotte and Sasha Banks. And I see where he's coming from up until Hell in a Cell. And now it's just getting really dry. But before then, it was actually really sick. I loved, they're definitely, I even said it was the next Lita and Trish. Like, this
I
is the
it's
next
broken
big
that
feud.
Because of the types of matches they've had.
Yeah.
And I mean, I know we haven't had the Iron Man match on the main roster yet with the woman that's happening this
Sunday.
We'll
see what happens in the future, man. This is just building up for their long and future
I know feud. People want to, like, I want this feud to be over. Everyone wants this feud to be yeah. over. But you can't deny that the impact that this feud has had on women's
yeah.
wrestling.
100%. My pick was Sami Zayn and Owens, not even going off the bias here. I was just, after what I just said, these guys can have a feud. Or could even not have a feud. They just got put in a match. Was it last Raw or two Raws ago? There wasn't even a feud there. And they put on an epic match. They don't even need to have a feud to have an epic match. So when they did have a feud this year, and then the backstory and how personal it got, they got into their personal lives, it was just epic. I can't believe how well they did that. And
they...
Oh, man. I don't know how
they elevated it from what they did in NXT, too.
They could have... It would have been 100% certified... feud of the year if there was for a title and Sami Zayn was able to win a title
from Kevin Owens.
Kevin Owens. That would have just
I think at some point
icing on the cake and that would have been great.
I think at some point they will have a title match.
And I think maybe if that happens, what if Zayn stays on Raw and ends up winning the Royal Rumble and there's a triple threat match at WrestleMania and it's like Owens, Balor, and Sami Zayn and Zayn wins it. That'd be fucking amazing. Book it, WWE. Book it.
What did the Twitter fans say?
Twitter fans for the feud of the year said... Nope, this is Superstar of the Year. Feud of the Year. Oops, I screwed up. I'll get to it, ladies and gentlemen. There it is. Feud of the Year. You guys out there said, Colin puts Dane O'Brien and Shane McMahon versus Mick Foley and Stephanie McMahon. Okay. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Chow puts, I don't know, WWE Superstars versus the drug policy. # suspensions for all. He has a picture of Brock Lesnar, Roman Reigns, Paige Del Rio, and Eva Marie.
Wow. God.
Casey Salas puts Cena versus Styles. Yep, I can appreciate yep. that. And Phil on Wrestling puts Miz versus Daniel Bryan.
That's a good... See, a couple of those, the Stephanie feud and this feud, like, they're non-in-ring feuds.
Yeah.
But we
and,
stuck
we can appreciate those,
feuds.
And I can get behind that, too. The Miz and Daniel Bryan thing, I hope... It's not going to lead to a match. WWE won't ever clear Bryan for some reason.
Nope, never.
So I wish that would lead to a match, and maybe WrestleMania. Maybe they finally just let Bryan have one more match, and it's against The Miz, because I think that could be a really, really good match.
But the way they had that whole talking smack thing, that was like promo of the year.
And then they just went nowhere from that. That's what I hated about that. Ugh.
So, yeah, we both have different winners for that, but we respect each other's opinions. Yep. Going into match of the year. I think we need to play the intro breaking news.
Intro breaking news. Award. For our last review, this is our match of the year. That's right. Welcome to Match of the Year, and it's our final award of the show, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, we could have went with male superstar of the year or female, but again, there's two different categories. Had to keep it fair. So we decided to go with Match of the Year for the last award of the show, and we have six nominees this year.
Yeah, the most we had for any award because there are just so many. 2014, We had Evolution versus the Shield Part 2 at Payback.
Yeah, that was sick. I actually remember that. That's where Seth Rollins jumped off the Titantron. Yeah. Yep.
Daniel Bryan versus Triple H at WrestleMania. The Miracle Kid, the Miracle on Bourbon Street.
Yeah.
And the winner was the Wyatts versus the Shield at Elimination Chamber.
Ooh, yes, I remember. That actually was a late put in, and we actually had to go back and see that. And that was a really good match. Boy,
shout out to No Sell Phil for pointing that out.
Yeah, we remember that two years ago.
Forgot about last year. I don't want to forget about 2015. It was a great year, you know? Yeah. 2015 match of the year. John Cena versus Kevin Owens at Battleground/Money in the Bank.
That was sick. But those two matches were so... Those were match of the year for me. I think those are still match of the year.
Undertaker versus Brock Lesnar at Hell in a Cell. That was more of a nostalgia match.
Yeah.
And the winner was a late addition. The New Day versus the Lucha Dragons versus the Usos in a triple threat TLC match for the tag titles. Jesus. That was match of the year last year.
I have to go back and watch it. I think I changed my pick to Kevin Owens because Kevin Owens and Cena put on an epic match. I remember
that tag team match just being spot central. Yeah. So that was where the Salida del Sol off the
ladder. Yes. Yeah.
And going into this year, these nominations, man, this was so hard to choose from.
Yep.
We've got Styles versus Ziggler on SmackDown. That was just a regular match, but it was like the best.
It was good.
Match
that was definitely match of the year. We wrote it down right away. We're like, my God, this has to be match of the year. It went on for like 25 minutes, and a guy like Styles and Ziggler in a match like that on SmackDown, out of all places.
And now we're not doing the Lowdown show this week, but Ziggler is now the number one contender for the WWE World Championship.
Oh, that's going to be so good. Styles and Ziggler again. That's going to be so good.
Maybe they realized how good this match was.
And point that out because we're not doing the Lowdown show this week. It's in Chicago. I think someone tweeted to CM Punk, like, are you going to show up to Chicago SmackDown and screw over AJ Styles? And like CM Punk trolls, like, yo, yes, definitely, I will be there.
Some guys are probably like flipping out, like, oh my God, he's actually going to be there. Marks.
Yeah.
Finn Balor versus Seth Rollins at SummerSlam. It was overshadowed by the crowd being pissed off about the Universal title belt.
Yeah.
But it was still a great match that they shouldn't have taken away from that match.
Yeah.
Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens at Battleground. You've talked about that.
It's such a good match. Such a good match. If you guys haven't seen that or forget it, go rewatch it. That was probably the best match out of the feud, Kevin Owens versus Sami Zayn, and it was over the top, and that was the one where they made the shirt from, the Fight Forever shirt. It was out of that match right there. It was so well done.
Next, we've got Sasha Banks versus Charlotte versus Becky Lynch at WrestleMania. Probably the best match on WrestleMania, the only good match that was on that card, really.
Yeah, and so far, it's up there with Lita and Trish's like best women's matches of all time.
Or even with Victoria and Jazz.
It was just so well done, to ignite the women's revolution. This was the best match to do it.
From start to finish, from their entrances to the match, to the way it ended. The ending was kind of sour, the way Ric Flair held Sasha, but it made sense that Charlotte won dirty and Becky tapped to that. But it was still a great way to kick off the women's revolution. We've seen where they've taken it from here.
Yeah.
So we'll be looking back at that match in years to come and say, like, that's where it started, you know?
For sure.
Honorable mention to The Miz versus Dolph Ziggler at No Mercy.
My God, man.
Or even at Backlash as well.
So good. So good. These two can put up... They're like a Zayn and Owens. Like, maybe not as good, but they're like a Zayn and Owens-esque. Like, they can have a match without a feud, and it'll be a really good match.
But what a feud, because it was the one at No Mercy was if Ziggler didn't win, he had to retire.
Yeah, he had to retire. So that made that match even more epic and more meaningful.
I remember my dad, who doesn't watch wrestling, was watching that match with me. He's like, wow, that match was an unreal match. And like,
so a guy who doesn't watch wrestling, guys, a guy that's less of a casual, thought that was a good match. That's how good of that match, and that's why that deserves an honorable mention.
And just the pop that Ziggler got when he finally broke through and finally beat The Miz after so many times getting screwed over by Maurice and whatever.
100%.
So that's got to be close second. Yeah. But we both went with this winner, AJ Styles versus John Cena at SummerSlam.
And we chose this, guys, because of the feud. The feud built the match. And it that's what makes a perfect feud. And a feud from start to finish, before the match even happens, builds the match before you even watch it.
And even
you know
story,
it's a good feud.
The storytelling in the match, like the match was itself.
It was incredible. Like them breaking the fourth wall added so much hype for this match.
And you can say what you want about John Cena. I mean, we don't like John Cena as much as the next guy, but he was unbelievable in this match.
Yeah. This was so good and so well done.
It was a match that everybody wanted to see for so long because it was a match that never could have happened.
And the club were banned from ringside. That's even made it even more. So you know it was going to be one-on-one. is going to be Styles vs. Cena, no interruptions.
And Styles won clean with the phenomenal
And Styles forearm. Won fucking clean. That's what even made it even that more epic like on sickest, top of that.
That was such a good phenomenal forearm, and the way Cena sold it, too. Like, it was such a great ending. And people were like, is Cena actually going to... Is he going to bury Styles?
Yeah.
Nope. Styles prevails over Cena clean.
Yeah. It was so
good.
Such
a good performance by both of them. The spot central in that match. I 100% match of the year. Yeah. Cena versus Styles. 100%
at SummerSlam. I hope that actually wins match of the year at the real Slammies, but it's probably going to be Zayn and Nakamura, or it's going to be really, really close, so we'll see what happens then. But let's get to your Twitter responses. Let's see what you guys think of match of the year this year. Colin puts, this one is tough, but I'm going to give it to Miz versus Ziggler.
Yep.
Okay. Makes sense.
Yep.
Casey Salvas puts Miz versus Ziggler. Oh, how do you guys love that match? Michael Chow puts Cena versus Styles at SummerSlam. Hashtag beat up John Cena. Tyler Jones puts Ziggler versus Miz. Wow. It wasn't at SummerSlam, Ty. It was at No Mercy. That's what you meant. Tired Irrelevance puts every TakeOver match the Revival was involved in. Since NXT is a part of WWE, I can do this.
Sure, Irrelevance. Since you're going off the script today, you might as well.
Phil didn't know you were making separate one from NXT, so he put Survivor Series tag team match for tag team. So the Survivor Series tag team match he thought was good.
Okay. I actually missed that match because I went to go get my stupid Chris Jericho shirt.
But he puts match of the year Shinsuke Nakamura versus Sami Zayn.
That was our NXT match of the year.
Yeah, and he thinks it was WWE's match of the year.
Yeah.
And I agree. It's a really, really good match, and it could be one of those matches that could send over the top and be considered overall a good match. But in our opinion, Styles versus Cena took the cake this year.
What a feud.
Just because the Zayn and Nakamura feud wasn't as good as the Styles and Cena feud, and that's what sent it over the top. It was just a match that we finally
got to see between two great wrestlers that are still in their prime, not like a nostalgia match between like Hulk Hogan and someone. They were actually still in their like... They were still in their prime, and they were able to put up a great match. So, shout outs to Styles and Cena. And that's why we didn't want to give Styles every fucking award this year.
But you know how good he was. He was incredible this year, and he's the GOAT. Like, the only champion, the only, like, triple crown champion in the three major companies. So, you know, we can't give him all the awards.
What a year for Styles.
Yeah, what a year. Literally. If you look at Styles from January to before WrestleMania, you couldn't have told me that he was going to have a bigger year as he just had.
Especially because they buried him to Jericho.
Yeah.
And they buried him to Reigns.
After that, I'm like, oh my god, it's over. Styles is just going to become...
Brand split.
This is just Vince McMahon kicking TNA into the trash.
The brand split was the best thing they ever happened to AJ Styles, because now he's the top guy on SmackDown.
He's the champ that runs the camp.
He's the MVP of that brand.
The face that runs the place.
He's the most valuable to his brand from 100%. Anybody.
Oh, I 100% agree.
From Raw or SmackDown, he's the most valuable to his brand.
100%.
What a show.
What a show, guys. And that's it. We're in We're on 2 hours into the show right now. 2 hours and 6 minutes long right now. What a show. We knew it was going to be this long, guys.
It's my favorite show of the year.
Yep, and it's our NHBWP Slammies, our third annual. Thanks for participating, and thanks for voting out there, guys.
Yep, and try to get your votes in, or your tweets coming, so that you can be the Twitter Fan of the Year next year.
Keep up the good tweets and participate in the Lowdown Show, and you could be Twitter Fan of the Year next year and have your own theme song, like Michael Chow. So, other than that, guys... That's going to wrap it up for the third annual NHBWP Slammy Awards on No Holds Barred Wrestling Podcast. We are a Canadian-based WWE podcast that reviews and discusses about the WWE and have award shows like this on No Holds Barred, anything we say. Pun intended!
Oh, as always.
As always, pun intended. Be sure to check out the Lowdown Show, Brand Wars, every week on the podcast, where we discuss and review Monday Night Raw and Tuesday Night SmackDown, and also 205 Live from that past week, as well as the Sunday Night Heat, where every Sunday, maybe sometimes Sundays, where myself, Kyle Masters, rants and discusses trending topics in the WWE. You haven't had one in a while. We'll see if I can get one out there soon. Remember, you can follow the podcast on Twitter and join in on the conversation by tweeting at No Holds Barred WP, as well as listen to all previous episodes from the podcast on YouTube, Spreaker, and Podbean. As well, and as always, I am your self-proclaimed greatest host, Kyle Masters. And I'm continuing to be joined by my co-host, Mr. Corporate himself, the Blissful Boss.
Hopefully for a long time, two-time champ.
Two-time champ, Corporate Cappy.
Yep.
Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for voting, guys. See you next time. The bookworm gets the brain, and I'ma get it all. Then I'm waiting all my